though Cloud9 isn't the most, I guess, together team compared to some of the other squads we have in ATLC. Their individual skills certainly can carry them. When you think about some of the most iconic players in Hearthstone, two of them belong in Cloud9, and Ekop's been there for a long time too, as one of the best players, not only just in Germany, but in all over Europe as well. So take a look at the lineups. We have Hunter Warrior, Rogue Mage, Paladin Warlock for Cloud9. And differences seem to be Druid versus Paladin on the other side here. And people have been flopping between Druid and Paladin as kind of like the number six, with, you know, with a shout out to being able to see a priest once in a while, Gar, wink, wink. How do you feel about these guys' lineup when you take a look at it?
If I can go first, I just feel it's kind of weird that there's absolutely not a single shaman being considered, because I think it's still, like, even though it's one of the weakest classes, I feel some players, like a Hawkeye is a good example of that, where he will stick to it, and I don't think it's a class that's going to lose necessarily in a Conquest format. Like, it's not something I'd play in a Last Hero Standing necessarily. But in Conquest, I think you can abuse some of the matchups that's going to run into, say Paladin and Handlock sometimes. If you can target those, I think it makes a bit of sense.
Yeah, I think for Liquid, it's all about the Druid. Like, that you pick a right matchup for the Druid pick.
Right.
Like you mentioned earlier, it is really like the weak link of a setup. We saw that like with Oskarka, that he like almost got reverse swept. But also other teams were struggling with Druid. You really need to get like the right matchup. And the best matchups for Druid are Controller, if they bring that, which is rarely. But Freeze Mage is like the number one deck, because almost everyone brings Freeze Mage. And then, yeah, there's actually not many other matchups that are good for Druid. But it's like overall a good like deck against anything in a sense. And that's the Druid is like the infamous six deck. Like, you have to bring six decks, and every team has like five good decks. And then you have to go for something like a priest or a shaman, aggro paladin, Druid. And Druid is like in the same boat. And Savish is like, in my opinion, the best, together with Thais, like the best Druid player in Europe. And it's like no surprise that he's like very confident.
Yeah, I was going to say, don't forget about Thais right now. But you picked him up, obviously. Makes a lot of sense, I think. All right, so turns out we're in the first game with Ekop and Nerea. Warrior versus Mage.
Yeah, but more specifically, it looks like it gravitates toward the Patron Warrior versus the Freeze Mage. Now, Patron Warrior versus Freeze Mage is not as bad as Control Warrior versus Freeze Mage, where you can stack up a bunch of armor. But I know some players still feel like it's a little tough for the Freeze Mage, because Patron Warrior is good at being able to apply a decent amount of pressure while still racking up the armor, but it's definitely not as bad. What do you think about this matchup, Gar? Like, what is there like percentages that you can assign out, or is there just a general?
It's actually like, very interesting. Yeah, because there's different strategies you have to go for. Like, as a freeze mage, you can theoretically fatigue the Patron Warrior if everything goes right. But the main strategy is obviously to try to draw the Antonidas plus Emperor, Alexstrasza, and all that stuff, and just rush him down before he draws the Armorsmiths. It's like very dependent on who draws the key cards first. Like for the Warrior, double Armorsmith is obviously, if you get like a double Armorsmith with Emperor, you can stack up 100 armor or whatever. And then there's no chance to win as the Freeze Mage. And then you just wait for the double frothing and OTK him. But one interesting thing is that many, like I talked with many pro Freeze Mage players, and they think the counter to tech the Freeze Mage is like double Flame Strike. And I've seen nobody going for double Flame Strike. This is like actually very important to deal with the patrons, because you can't really clear patrons of Blizzard.
Yeah, that's a great point, actually. I really like that. Like, otherwise, you really need to get a board wipe exactly on point, whether that's, you know, you have spell damage in some way. I guess there could be an argument to be playing spell damage instead of that, but in Freeze Mage, it's kind of hard to fit in. Besides Blood Mage.
But yeah, the playstyle actually changed a little bit from Patron. Like like 1 or 2 months ago, it was really a focus on just getting the patrons out. But now it's more like a focus on just killing your opponent with double frothing.
Yeah, it's a cycle heavy metagame, or the cycle heavy version of the patron seems to be much more equipped at the metagame, because people feel like they play much better around patron. No one's leaving 2 attack or less minions on the board. You know, they're really trying to make sure to minimize the effect of it. They're also like trying to minimize the amount of minions played on board. But like, even though Patron doesn't necessarily need to, the minions on board, Execute being burned here.
Yeah, I like that from Nerea. He pinged the Acolyte of Pain from Ekov just to make him draw an additional card. You never know when you're going to remove something absolutely crucial to his win condition.
Yeah, he got the Emperor, which is kind of good, but as you can see, it's not too much value. His double Inner Rage, Execute, Unstoppable Ghoul, a lot of cheap cards, Wheelwind. Just a Frothing, which is like a key card, but he doesn't get it on Patrons or Warzone Commander or anything else.
Wow, the second sweep on the Thorazon is going to be so nice too. Just wow, be able to set up things really cheap.
I've like, never seen someone winning a game with losing a game with double Emperor turns.
Mm-hmm.
Except he has like no cards in his hand.
Yeah.
Well, he could get some with the Acolyte, I guess. The thing is, he really has to keep his Whirlwind to make that Frothing an OTK effectively.
Maybe.
Yeah, I think he wants to at least try to get other cards of value into his hand. I was thinking maybe even cycling, slamming the Acolyte, but I don't know if he wants to part ways with an Inner Rage and keeps Thorazon alive. I don't know if that matters or not.
Oh man, that sucks.
This is so tricky because you want a Whirlwind, but then you're like, wait, I can't do that. I really want that second trigger.
No, Inner Rage is fine to use. Like the card, you might actually even consider like Inner Raging the Acolyte to get the effect on another card.
And
Inner Rage is really not an important card.
Well, with double Frothing, it's a little bit more damage, but it's not going to be the biggest deal. So Alex are getting picked up here. I mean, this is gonna be... Do you think he's gonna go for the rush or try to mail his opponent as much as possible?
When you look at Darius' face, he's like super bored. he's like, my god, he got double Emperor, I'm dead.
Yeah, rest in peace, Nerea. Contemplating the end of his life.
Cheap. His whole hand costs 3 mana. The thing about the Patron Warrior, too, is that you don't need to have any minions on your opponent's side. You can create 40 damage through 2 Frothing Berserkers just with your own board, assuming you have a Dread Corsair or, you know, maybe an Unstable Ghoul that you can wipe out and get some whirlwind damage.
Yeah.
And
your own Patron. Yesterday, like, he can play his entire hand and then play a Ragnaros on 8 as well.
That's right.
Welcome to Frothing Warrior. Not even patient
really
anymore.
The Frothing Berserkers? Everyone keeps pointing at Warsong Commander as one of the main culprits of making this deck like far too explosive because it's what gives it charge is the biggest problem.
I actually would even go away from both and say Battle Rage because Battle Rage was always broken, but in this deck it is like it works.
Yeah, it's one of those things like initially you remember Battle Rage was changed a few times, but Warsong Commander as well. Like it used to enable the OTK with Molten, then it was changed and Charge was changed and everything kind of was dormant for a long time. We really didn't need to worry about it. And then Patron comes up. It's like, hey, you remember all those cards you thought would never see play again? Well, you know, joke's on you.
It's so
back.
Crazy when you play against the deck about the things you have to play around. Like, as soon as he plays an Acolyte, you have to prevent 3 draws or 2 draws. As soon as he... Like, you have to play around the turn 6 Emperor. You have to play around the Death Spite. Mm-hmm. You have to play around Battle Rage. You have to play around the Patrons. You have to play around the Frothing OTK. It's like just too many things.
Double Mass Dispel, double Light Bomb, Harrison Jones, double Priest coming up.
I'll solve all your problems with one thing. Snipe. Go.
Oh man.
Kill the Warsong Commander and their strategy dies in the water.
Yeah. And they'll never expect it either, right? They'll just be like, wait, what just happened? Yeah. Lloyd did that to someone. I remember like he played against Patron Warrior and Rogue and he killed a Drake and then killed the Warsong Commander on the following game. I was very amused.
That's like a new level of saltiness. I was watching Purple Drank playing Snipe Hunter and people played around Snipe. And
oh wow, was he that's really funny if you're like playing your friends, right?
Oh, the armorsmith here gets developed, so he's gonna be able to get himself some armor.
Yeah.
Get a range of
even card draw with Battle Rage. That's too many cards, actually.
Yeah, I was gonna say that's like getting a bit maybe too high. Maybe just cycle the Inner Rage and kill the Doomsayer.
That really nerfed Patron Warrior.
Oh! What happened? Zale happened.
Oh my goodness.
This is not good for Ekov.
Like, the way from his.
He ran
out
of time.
He forgot to kill it.
He just ran out of time, man.
He queued it up, but I think he tried queuing it up, but it just wasn't fast enough.
Oh man, he's capable of handling the Blinktron from the area, but
yeah,
he
but
burnt also something, right?
Not only is he like he's not drawing another card because the Acolyte died, but he also lost his armor smith without gaining more armor.
That is insane.
Yeah, I mean at this point, Ariel will just unload the Frostbolts and the two Ice Lances, and his opponent's gonna be so low on health. I don't see the OTK coming right up. There's an ice block set up, so the amount of damage that Ekop has to prevent here is just too big.
Yeah, that was unfortunately a sloppy outcome for Ekop, just because he was not able to get it. Because that changes a lot here, whether or not he's able to potentially survive with all the whirlwind effects on Armorsmith. He would have had better resources at his disposal. He would have dealt with Alexstrasza more efficiently.
He picks it up at least. He does get the Armorsmith, for all that's worth. I don't know yet how much that's worth, but with a little bit.
It definitely helps, but his opponent just converted into four fireballs, and he still has a pyroblast. That's 40 damage of burn. And I always think warrior is great and be resilient, but not that resilient. Double armor smith would have been crazy, though.
What's interesting is last week Colento was their patron player, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And they mixed that up. Ekop plays it. Maybe he's like more confident or so, I don't know. Maybe he saw misplays, I don't know.
That's definitely possible. It might have discussed it a bit.
Which I think this is like interesting. Usually you discuss like who plays which classes and then you stick with it. Like because you practice those classes that they change then. I think this is interesting. But this is like, yeah, GG.
Yeah, he queued up his actions at least. For all that's worth, so that's gonna force Nerea probably to just unload all the fireballs over two turns. What if Ekop has that crazy Kazan Mystic and Nerea just goes all in with the fireballs? What if?
Well, I don't know. It's still tough to say. He still has two whirlwind effects, and the Armorsmith can gain a lot of life here.
He has a gazillion fireballs.
A zillion, that's about right. I feel like Patron is only kept in check balance-wise by the rope. Like, Blizzard is probably gonna keep the rope as it is just because of Patron. Like, that deck is not broken because rope.
Because no Dormu.
No, man.
Because people are not taking that in.
That's their fault, man. I have a few decks if I ever face Life Coach or Trump. They'll have Miss Dormu.
What you need to do is start recombobulating your 9 drops into Nosedormu.
I know Justine was doing that for a while, like some Control Warrior variant who was using Recombobulator.
Yeah, it makes sense given that how many heavy legendaries you have already. Sometimes it's a heal too, because there's like, if you recombobulate a giant, there's really no other card that costs that much, so you just heal it back up. Oh my goodness, more fireballs.
If you think about it, would it have... I mean, yeah, the whirlwind effects would have changed the outcome. I was going to say, like, would it have mattered, really, if the Armor Smith had lived with the Acolyte?
Oh, yeah, I think it could have been a big changer because of a double Armor Smith getting a lot of whirlwind effects. And his opponent only had Frost Nova. He finally drew Blizzard, but he would have doubled up the armor he gotten, I think.
Right.
With better card resource at his disposal, too, because remember, he lost 3 cards, he had to dump a few more. He would have had a full board of whirlwinds going on double Armorsmith.
Yeah.
That's a lot.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, the double Armorsmith, I think, is a key point.
Yeah,
you're right.
Yeah, usually you save, you never play just one Armorsmith. But that was like a little bit of a facepalm. Like, where.
A little bit. E-cup
a little bit, yeah. Ekop was more than facepalming. Yeah, like, face desking at this point.
Face desking. I mean, Nerea has like 12, 18, 28, plus ping, 29 damage. Easy.
I think this is enough damage to actually pop the block, which is funny enough.
Which is ridiculous.
Like, yeah, Patron still manages to hypothetically threaten the freeze mage.
Yeah, actually, it's just short, isn't it? Oh no, the 5 damage is actually enough.
Yeah, 5 damage. Enough.
That is so
funny.
So ridiculous.
That's 29 damage, I think, right? Or 28 damage. So funny. Well, Nerea takes this one very convincingly. Pyroblast to wrap it up, and Team Liquid off to a good start. And again, you know, I can't put enough hype behind Nerea. I only can say it so many times. I think that he is probably one of the most underrated players in the entire league. People look at other guys to be more hyped that might be up and coming. They're finally paying attention to Tiddler and some of the other guys on Celestial. You know, they look at like, you know, Kibler and Dog over on Value Town, but don't ignore guys like Nairia who are super rock solid and very innovative too.
I think something about Kibler is that his performance up until this point hadn't been, you know, stellar, but he's been doing super well in the Archon Team League, so people pay a lot of attention to him. But Nairia's been around for a long time. Yeah, he's 4-0. It's crazy.
Yeah, he's undefeated. Is he the only undefeated player in the league?
Yes, if I'm not mistaken. Unless, I think, who else was undefeated? Shocky was? Firebat was?
Oh, right? Yeah.
No, Shocky's still undefeated. No, he actually got Pally and Hunter to 1-0 each. Yesterday.
Okay. All right. That's right. So Chalky is also undefeated. I'm sure there's going to be some kind of stat tracking for that. I believe Amaz said that the person who performs the best individually gets a $5,000 bonus award called the Master of Duels.
Oh, wow.
In which case I, you know, lambasted him for calling it Master of Duels for about 5 minutes.
You qualify for the LAN finals. That's depressing.
That's probably it. You know, I think what they probably do is they probably take the best performing player out of someone who goes to the offline finals.
Right.
Yeah, but that's depressing. Imagine you don't go to offline finals, but you're best performing player.
You're like 20-0 for your team.
That's a new team.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, with this win here with Nairia, I just wonder, like, is Rogue... he's got a really good Rogue play. But I know the show played it a lot, so I wonder what the decision was to switch maybe the Warrior and the Rogue between both players.
Cool.
What? I think as long as you're relatively comfortable, and it could be that Clento just wanted to play other decks, and then they didn't want to give up Warrior at all. It could be something like that. Or Ecop, maybe he's saying, I've played a lot of Patreon, I feel comfortable, and Clento's like, okay, I'll just take something else.
Oh, no, like no, Ecop has the Warlock last.
Yeah.
And Strifecore has the Warlock.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah, and I think just mixing up is fine too because it keeps playstyles hard to predict as long as you're equally proficient at them, right? That's the key thing because if Ecop's not as good as a Patron Warrior player as Kalento is, then you're actually exposing yourself to potentially drop win percentage points that you don't need to.
Mm-hmm. So how many games have you seen before where Patron Warrior actually lost because of a rope problem? Like those are really it seems to happen very frequently. Like most of the time, I'll see like one game in a tournament is decided on that. Mm-hmm. Even tiny things like what Ecop had happened to him here. Like it was obviously an oversight not to kill a Doomsayer or a rope thing, more so than just something he would do naturally.
I think also in HTC. Like where Zele had a game with Patron and he started immediately the turn, like the frothing with Armorsmiths and stuff, immediately. Like as soon as it was his turn, he started the turn and he still missed like 9 damage in the end. It's like, some turns are like, you just don't have enough time like to do them.
Was that the game against you where he ended up like missing the lethal?
No, he was playing against, was that yesterday? Or was it last week? I think Zayla has had 2 events so far happen to him in this
Narcon. But he started immediately. Like, yeah, he didn't waste time. He didn't even think about it. And you still don't have enough time to finish the turn.
Yeah, that's what we get for Blizzard nerfing the rope sometime in the beta. Like it went from 90 seconds to 70. Like stealth changes.
I think it was Naxx Rammus around that time.
Yeah, because they released Belcher and they said, we want to make your life miserable at the same time.
Oh my goodness, I forgot about that, where the slime took like a year and a half to literally be excreted out of the body of the slug Belcher.
It's like, I think there's a slime here, but I can't tell. Entern.
Actually, there's a famous game between Savitz and Kibler where I think either Savitz or Kibler forgot about the slime and then like they just died because of it because like the slime just attacked the druid for 1 damage. Like he was at 1 HP and then
little slime that could.
All right, well, this is a couple of interesting opportunities to go for the curve here. It seems go ahead, Gar.
If he goes for the Shredder, he has like no play for the next 3 turns. That sucks.
Would you go as far as to keep the innervate for the Thorsen so that way you can like make everything else cheaper and fit according to the curve on 5 like, and 6?
Yeah. It really depends what Ecop does. Like now with the Lutor, now he has the option to just hero power. and kill the loot order. So he will probably just go for it and then he can the Emperor next turn. But yeah, if he wouldn't have played the loot order, he has like the claw into Shredder and then he might pick up something because Druid plays like 5-6-5 drops. It's very likely he draws into it. Now he just goes for the Emperor, which is very strong, obviously. Like also, if he doesn't have an answer to kill it, and if it, like if a Druid gets an Emperor for 2 turns, it's GG.
Oh, especially if Ancient of Lore manages to follow up on Emperor Thorsen, like on the second turn, that is just way too much.
Is it possible that it actually will be able to, though? Because looking at the hand from Ecop right now, he doesn't seem to have an answer to it. Even with the inner rage trade, he'd still have to pick up a weapon at the very least.
That's three draws.
He's got three draws to do it. It's not impossible.
So Vish is considering the Keeper as well. It's like nice to silence the Acolyte because that's one way to lose. If the warrior draws too many cards, right, the Emperor might not be enough.
Yeah. There is a good way for this to work out for Ecop, though, if he gets Deathspite this card.
Oh, that's important.
Well, that'll
if
do
he got
it.
Deathspite this card, he killed Thorsen, and then for turn 5, he had Inner Rage and Grim Patron Whirlwind combination.
That's another GG combo.
Yep.
Nah, he didn't get the weapon, so might as well use Inner Rage.
Yeah.
Wow, he's going to be able to coin that out next turn, sitting with the Patron and the double Frothing in hand, and the Commander! Oh, goodness.
Okay.
That's a really strong Emperor from Ecop. Because he gets it on the Patron and on the Frothing and on the Warzone Commander. It's like the three core cards.
Yeah, he's just missing like a Whirlwind here or like an Execute.
Yeah. But if he picks up a Whirlwind, man, is that enough? It's one mana.
We're seeing an answer from the opponent though, and it's also going to scare Savitz out of his mind. Like, yeah, this is the card that carries it.
Yeah, for both decks, the Emperor is so important.
What's the best way to deal with this? Because originally you wanted to drop the Ancient of Lore, but now you have to deal with the Emperor, so you just hero power instead of play Druid the Claw and trade with your Pilot Shredder.
Yeah, that's the annoying thing. You have to kill Emperor. You can't let it live. It's like no way. It's like 0%.
Well, you can if you're a secret spy for Cloud9.
You could Druid the Claw charge into the Armorsmith and the hero power with the Pilot Shredder.
What's even like the best drop out of a Pilot Shredder against Patron Warrior? I don't even know.
Mana Wraith. After that Emperor.
Oh, Mana Wraith. Yeah. Really funny.
Mana Wraith is not bad.
Lord Walker Show is actually pretty cool too. But... Oh, wow. Wild Pyro.
Wild Pyromancer.
Not the best.
Not the best if you want to kill off the patrons. I guess you can trade at least one. The spells are interesting dynamic there.
The Nerubah Replot is also pretty good. Because it doesn't affect any Druid minions, but affects all of them.
I guess. But then
affect, like Cruel Task, I guess. Yeah.
Yeah, Cruel Taskmaster and.
Oh man, it could be salty. No weapons. A lot of people cut the one War Axe. I don't know if Ecop did as well, but like, if it is the case, you see that it can be bad in some situations. Like not having any weapons is really, really bad, especially against Druid.
Yeah, this is a scenario with the Fiery War Axe would have been great to basically clear the what you see on the board here for the next couple turns.
Mm-hmm.
The really bad news, too, is that Harrison gets easily challenged by what's on board, and he can develop a free Ancient of Lore and just continue to threaten the same exact thing while even pushing for damage.
Yeah, like, which is the way it wins.
Is Armorsmith even worth dropping here? I don't feel like it is.
Oh, man, that's so sad. That like, he has a free real shade, and you can't kill it.
Yeah.
I mean, this gives Savish also so many informations. He knows 100% he has no weapon. He shouldn't be, like, it's pretty solid to go for the lore, I think.
Yeah.
I mean, you have to trade, if only for the fear that something crazy comes out of this, right?
You might
like after the Emperor turn, aren't you just afraid of some kind of frothing burst? There's no weapon, so the odds of that being in his hand are much higher. At least from your perspective. I don't know.
He's I get a little wary. Face with the shade. my trade, because it's like a positive trade, but I wouldn't be surprised, because if he had a way to kill the Shade last turn, he would have done it.
So that's, yeah, what, that's is a good interesting. Point, actually. These are both effectively 5/5s for the
Warrior. Yeah, and for the Druid.
Yeah.
That attack is, for example, very, very interesting. It's a very good play. Because the damage matters a lot for Druid.
Yeah, it's a really good point. I like that analysis. 7 mana gives him the ability to drop patrons with the Cruel Taskmaster and the War Song.
Like a whirlwind from the Emperor would have actually been amazing. That's the thing I would be worried about, I guess, from the Druid's perspective, is if there was a whirlwind in that hand with the Froddings, like this extra Shade and this extra Harrison Jones really count for a lot of more damage.
It feels like it should be okay, though, because you can clear the board here, which is what you definitely need to do now that Druid's like starting to pressure you a little bit. Because you can use the Cruel Taskmaster body into the Pyromancer, and you can use the initial damage Grim Patron.
You
have to, actually, yeah.
I mean, you're dead to Savage Roar.
Right.
That's okay. Which is really funny, is that with Wild Pyromancer, you actually can't force Nature and Savage Roar.
Yeah, that's so funny. Off everything on the board. Oh, man. I've seen people doing greetings against me on ladder and then using the combo and conceding afterwards.
Muster for Battle is not a good play with a Wild Pyromancer on the board.
Is he gonna rope again?
Oh my god, he's running out of time.
Nah, he's gonna be fine.
Okay.
I need to play some StarCraft too and get some APM.
Yeah, seriously.
Yeah. We're gonna get like training camps for Hearthstone. Click the Grim Patron as fast as possible.
Oh man.
Mm.
This is like, Savish can't even kill the Patron. This is so rare that you see that.
The life of a Druid.
That is so unfortunate. Yeah, it's like
you have to silence it, basically.
Oh, man.
Play Belcher.
Yeah, but usually...
What happens with the War Song, then?
Well, what's really usually bad about the Keeper is, like, if you deal with the Patron, he's another Patron coming.
Yeah.
And if
you
deal with the War Song, the Patron copies itself. And it's like, oh.
Yeah, on top of it, usually the War Song is a bigger threat than the Patron.
Yeah.
Like, I was talking with Cyan, and like, before you kill the Patron, you kill the Warsong. Because he can spawn like a bunch of Patrons, but he can't attack with them. But now he can.
Oh, man.
You see? He's like a second Patron, you can just do.
Oh, the execute draw.
I'm dying here for Savit as soon as he sees the second Patron. And the execute's also exactly what enables the reproduction of the dwarves, I guess. It's kind of.
What is very interesting is because, like, from the way how Eco played and everything, Savish could figure out that he has no Whirlwind effects because he would have definitely used it last turn.
Right.
So he needed to top deck a Whirlwind effect. So probably like Silence in the Warzone Commander is slightly better, but it doesn't matter. Actually, it does matter.
Was there any room to play something very board-centric like Sylvanas to force him into a complicated trade?
I thought he was going to play Sylvanas. Honestly, but the problem is if there's the Patron, because you can't silence the Patron at that point. So if he gets anything like an AoE, whatever it is, it can be anything really. Then you're in the worst.
Uh oh, he's really running out of time. He should attack with the War Song now.
Are we gonna see MC Tech?
Nice, fine. Oh wow, MC Tech value. You actually get the minion with the charge copy.
Oh, I wanna see. Steal frothing.
I wanna see Swipe Top deck with MC Tech.
I don't even know if that'd be enough.
Oh, Ecot missed one attack, I think, right? With the Grip Patron.
Still, oh man. The crazy thing is, Savish was ahead.
Yeah,
like,
and then
a lot, and then
all.
Suddenly, no chance.
Yeah, I mean, the Shrewd Drake and the swipe lets you kill nothing, actually. You're still going to take potentially lethal. I mean, you'd kill all the patrons and the frothing. You'd have two patrons and the War Song. You'd be on like two effective health. MC Tech with a Patron doesn't do anything. Yeah.
Well. Yeah.
Actually, if you innervate into Wild Growth, it gives you an extra card.
I don't think that's how it works, unfortunately.
I tried it a while back and it used to be like that. I'm not sure if they changed
it. I don't think it works because what happens is you're at 6 of 9 mana and then it just goes to 10 mana.
Oh, right, because you didn't do it on max mana, you're right. When you do it on 9, and then it gives you the Wild Growth.
A little bit of BM here. And I think Savitz doesn't want to show Ecop that he has Mind Control tech. So I think he's keeping Conquest in mind. So it's like, rather than showing him mind control tech, then I'll just end the game here.
This deck is so stupid. Ikob didn't pick up a single Whirlwind effect that game. Not a single weapon. And he had the and Savish had Innervate Emperor, and he still lost. That's like,
yeah, it's
but he drew the combo as pieces though, essentially. It's like one of those games where sometimes Druid doesn't really have much of their superpower stuff like Ancient of Lore, but they just happen to have both Force of Natures and both Savage Roars, and they just did like 28 damage to you in 2 turns. You're like, okay.
Yeah, you can't even stop it. You're dead
like,
on
you
6.
You should have powered me twice, and then I died through like 4 cards that just happened to be in your hand, you know, that type of thing.
Also, with that win, Eco prevented to be benched, which is always like a little thing.
Yeah, getting benched, people are discovering it's a really big deal. That's why I was even surprised ECOP got sent out again, because I feel like teams were starting to randomize their first three games based off of the lowest probability of being benched. So like ECOP would go, and then Shrivecrow or Kalento would go, and whoever didn't play would wrap up the first three games.
I mean, another you're going to have point. To worry about that. Like the benching is a really big deal in this format. Because if you really need that deck to come out, then like much later in the phase, I mean, of course, early on, you've got, you know, options with your decks. But once it narrows down to like 2 players or 3 players with like 1 deck, it becomes a problem.
Yeah. I agree. What is very interesting is usually people, like when they bring Druid, they really save it as the last deck or second last deck. And Team Liquid decided to send it out very early. Because you have to get that win on the Druid at some point, right? So it's always interesting to see how people pick and...
Yeah, I know that RDU and Life Coach, basically the entire team Nihilum, basically agrees for the most part that the picking order doesn't matter since you have to brute force your way through the win eventually. Yeah. But some other people are a little bit more meticulous about it. And I think it starts mattering when you have tech cards, like Harrison Jones, Kazan Mystic, MC Tech. That's when it matters.
That is a very important point. On top of that, some decks have bad and good matchups. Like, you want to, like, force your opponent into a bad matchup if possible, or in a good, or, like, bring yourself in a good position. I don't think it's, completely random. I mean, obviously, you try to, I mean, winning, you want to win in the end, right? So, just picking randomly, I don't know.
Yeah, winning's nice. Winning is nice. Better to win. You should try it sometime.
Yeah. Oh, wow. Shots fired.
No! Gara, you know I love you. You know, Rogue versus Druid is coming up here. This is a matchup that a lot of people favor one or the other, and they're really split across the opinions. Are you in the camp of Rogue or in the camp of Druid here, Gara?
I'm in the Rogue camp. Like, because people convinced me. People like Firebat really convinced me that, I mean, that the Rogue is favored at least. In that matchup, just because, I think Backstab Eviscerate is like the strongest card combination that Rogue has available. I mean, you innovate, like in the past, you used to like double innovate Druid of the Claw and then they kill it for 2 mana.
Yeah.
Yeah, tempo is just ridiculous. Like, Sap is so detrimental to Druid.
Yeah, Sap as well. It's
just crazy.
And the thing is, now you run cards like Healbot as well, so it's easier to play around the combo. Like in the past, you just went down to 14 life and there was nothing you can do about it. You just dead.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that Rogue is slightly favored for sure.
What about Harrison? How much does that change matchups against Rogue specifically? Because Harrison, the more I see it against Rogue, the more I feel like it's not actually as impactful as I think it would be, because Rogue ends up going for like a same turn Blade Flurry, right?
They exactly.
Their dagger, and then they just Blade Flurry.
That is 100% correct. The thing is that from all the weapon classes, it's by far the worst against Rogue, because they will always use the entire dagger in the same turn. It's very rarely they don't.
That's a great play here by Savi, just straight up denying the dagger and forcing his opponent to replay it. I mean, it sounds ridiculous, but it's so strong.
Oh, actually, Tiddler did something similar in the, I think, in the finals of DreamHack, where he used it against Master for Battle.
Oh my god, this is insane, yeah.
Just to draw the cards.
Yeah.
But it's a very good play.
Hmm.
the most value you're going to get, because very often, and I think Amaz pointed that out at some point, he said he looked at the weapon kind of like as a wild growth, because you set it up and it's going to stay there as two mana waiting to be used whenever you need it. So if you just delete it as fast as possible, even without the buff, I mean, sure, you're not denying the ultimate value, but you're still doing pretty well with it. Oh, wow. Oh,
that is sick.
That is really unexpected, but I guess he really can't afford to take, you know, 15 damage.
He's like, Savish, you think I can't kill your Harris?
Tit for tat.
But he's... Now, the thing is, one very strong thing is, like, if you know Harrison is out of the picture, you can really save up your big dagger and use it whenever you want.
You can
usually
camp
you have
hard.
To play around Harrison. Yeah. Yeah. This guy's
toast. So now he can do whatever
he
wants.
That he went for the deadly poison here and not the South Sea. I guess because what I was anticipating was that Bioteacher can come out and the deadly poison would effectively do the same thing and you get a 1-1 with it. But I guess this way he plays around swipe and the South Sea doesn't die for free.
And he's saving it for the second oil, so it's like most likely to play double oil.
Fair enough.
Most people do. But now he saw the swipe, right? Mm-hmm. So he's really considering it to just push for damage because he's out of, like, he has no more cards.
Yeah, that's another thing too that what I like about the Harrison play is that Rogue can often run out of its own resources very easily by trying to get tempo. If you just have so much to bully it, then Rogue can't do much and has to rely on sprint.
His dagger is going to pay off, and 4 attack would have been too little to deal with the Lothab, and even though he can't play spells, he's still able to keep pushing. And Savitz, without any removal, it's kind of annoying, because it doesn't take that long for the Rogue to stack up damage.
Yeah, like, if you can't deal with a Violet Teacher, that's usually a very, very bad sign.
Mm-hmm.
Here's the thing, though.
Oh, well.
A lot of tempo can be gained. A lot of tempo is being generated through Kalenta. Like, it might be the point where Druid has a lot of resources, but the sheer board just keeps snowballing for Kalenta here. He's just going to get more 1-1s, and until there's another swipe, he's going to continue to push through this.
Yeah, that's what Rogue does best. That's what I like about them, is they can be... They're kind of like aggro control. More so than a control, like a pure control deck. They will be able to go face much earlier than other decks would be able to.
By the way, another random fun fact. Yesterday, Kalenta climbed to rank 1 legend with Rogue.
No, you don't say.
Yeah. That was fun. Thank you, Akara.
Yeah.
I enjoyed learning about that. Kalenta hit legend.
I didn't watch it.
I mean,
so I
yesterday.
Known.
Also, the sun also rises and waters.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say.
You know, outside of those big anomalies, I think Kalenta getting number 1 legend really shouldn't surprise people that much.
Whoa. It was yesterday. Oh, wow. So, like, come on. It was actually this morning.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't watch him, so I didn't know if it was fun. Are we saying the fact was fun? If you were saying the fact was fun, then I agree.
Yeah.
You're making fun of my fact.
Fun fact. No, I didn't. I wasn't directed to the fact. It was directed
painting
to the
haters.
Yeah. Gar haters. Damn.
That eviscerate draw, behaving. Though, by the way.
Yeah,
like, that was like exactly the scenario you were talking about, Gara. It's like that backstab is just great to get a lot more tempo and be able to push again on the board.
Yeah, even though he has like a heavy card disadvantage, it doesn't matter. Like, the Violet Teacher is like carrying. You can't remove it and spawn so many 1-1s. He saw the swipe. It's just nothing a Druid can do. Druid is like, also in the Patreon game, as we saw, that's like why Druid is so weak right now. It can't deal with a board. Like, once Druid loses the board, it's like nothing he can do. It's like no card he has. Except poison seed, it's noxious.
Start to
Kalenta just played around double combo with Innervate because he saw that his opponent had Thorsen, so he's like, on the very off chance that he has like those exact 4 cards with Emperor Thorsen in hand, I will heal myself from 22 to 25. Otherwise, he should have healed the Violet Teacher for more board resilience.
Yeah.
And Kalenta does his turn so fast. Like, there were for him some turns are no-brainers, but even when you have like 3 different options. I really enjoy playing seeing like Kalenta Rogue.
Wow. He plays it very fast. So he plays it much faster than everyone else, honestly. Like, I've seen a lot of experienced Rogue players and they will take a lot of time. But Kalenta goes all in a lot more often than other players I've noticed with Rogue, and it works out. Like, he steals wins very frequently with that approach.
That's what Rogue has to do. Honestly, it's the reality here. Like, Rogue, Rogue needs to be able to seize tempo when given the opportunity. And just look, like, Kalento's hand early on seemed pretty decent, but Savitz warranted aggression. And I don't think there's anything really Savitz can do here to
Did Savitz play Druid now twice in a row?
Yes, this would mean he's benched if he's dead.
Oh, that feels bad, man.
It feels extra bad because I think Kalento is also chilling in Korea. And he's just kind of like maybe in a hostel or in the airport or something. You can't even play the extra mana that he gets from Wild Growth. Oh, wait, never mind. He didn't even get it because he was at 9.
That's depressing.
Dang. Well, for all that pomp and circumstance that we gave to Team Liquid, they're down early and Savitz is benched. Yikes.
What was Savitz's second class? Warlock?
Warlock, I think.
So,
or was that? Yeah, that was it. That was Warlock.
Oh man, that's actually very important. I think they will go with the Freeze Mage now, right? Like, if you know for sure Druid is like out of the picture,
Show still has Warrior.
Yeah, I know, but it's Patron, so it's not like, oh my god, Autolus.
Well, Show could bring control, right?
Yeah,
I think I really liked what Shrifko said yesterday. He said the strategy maybe isn't what's best against the remaining. It's about what is really weak against the person that got benched. So what is really weak against Druid and Warlock?
Freeze
here?
Mage.
Freeze Mage is pretty much the only... This is the only class, I think.
It's difficult to say what kind of Warlock Savage plays. Probably it's Demon Zoo. It's like what you always tend to guess. But like even Fawson played Maligos Lock yesterday. So...
Yeah.
People will try
Handlock
to
I'd bring in would, game.
Yeah, maybe.
Paladin?
Yeah,
No, Paladin is good against both decks. Paladin is probably the best.
But if it's Zoo though, is it really, I don't even know if Paladin's that good against Zoo.
Oh, Paladin is like the best deck against Zoo. That's like the only really good matchup.
Oh wait,
it's like
I'm thinking good matchup. Aggressive Paladin, by the way. I didn't think it'd be mid-range Paladin. I have eliminated mid-range Paladin from my mind after Trump lost in a game.
Man.
This is so discouraging when I watch those series. It's like, you want this deck to work so bad, but at the same time, you realize, you know, going into it, like kind of like Druid sometimes, that it might not work out.
If Strifko brings Aggro Paladin, I'm out of here.
Yeah, yeah, I'd be surprised. If Strifko brings it, I quit Hearthstone. Well, might be lost.
I lose all hope. Strifko brings, like, Cancel Lock and Aggro Paladin. I'm gone.
Oh, man.
Yeah, I like Freeze Mage now that you analyze it in this capacity, and you reminded me that mid-range Paladin's a deck. and I think it'd be pretty good, because you want to keep the ability for having, like, Hunter against... especially if it's a mid-range slower Hunter, you can have it against Druid and the Warlock. And like you said, Paladin's best matchups are against Savitz.
And Strifko had an upset win with Paladin last week against Freeze Mage. He won with his Paladin, mid-range Paladin against Freeze Mage, which is pretty nice.
I think that's like the one day, I know he lost with his own mage, but his Paladin won, right? Without losing any games at all.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, I'd bring out any of like Strifko's decks.
I said Kalento plays Freeze Mage, but I don't know, right? It's just a guess. Yeah. It's like you see Mage, Kalento, it should be Freeze Mage.
I was going to say, like, I think Strifko could bring out Handlock here. It's also not excessively weak against anything that's on the other side. And it's also, if Patron Warrior tries to come out, then you've got something for it. But now it's going to go up against Show's Hunter, so that's not exactly what you're looking for.
Strifko has the coolest picture.
Yeah, it reminds me of Chen Stormstout from Warcraft.
Yeah, me too.
Like the exact thing. It's like Mists of Pandaria. Pandaren Crow? There we go.
Yeah.
I imagine that it might have some kind of expansion in the future too, or some type of content, right? Oriented around Pandaria.
Was there something released yet? Probably nothing, right? About the expansion, they always keep it so secret.
Yeah.
No, there is that well-met scroll that they're passing around.
That's
did
like...
you get one, Noxious?
I didn't get one. I got the GVG invention stuff.
Oh, cool.
Wow.
Cool.
That's cool.
That's sweet. Yeah, I got the scroll. I felt really left out of the GVG invention thing, but it feels good to be on the inside for once.
Did you analyze the scroll? Did you pick something up?
I did. I actually tried to find what the scroll was made of through some scientific experiments. Got my little beakers.
Detective Froden.
To trace the materials.
Soon.
Well, you should distill it and inhale. Like, if you know the content of liquid and what it's made of, you can probably figure out where it comes from, and then you can probably reconstruct what was around it and possibly know what was on the screen near, you know, where it was created. So maybe you'll get the cards before everyone else does.
All right. Well, we seem to go with Warlock here from Strifecrow up against the Hunter from Show. I don't know if that's exactly what Cloud9 wanted, given that, again, Savitz is benched, which means he can't come back until another member from Liquid wins, whether Show or Nairia. So this is a really important thing, because if Show loses, Savitz is still benched. Oh, no, never mind. Just kidding. They reminded me yesterday. So if Show loses, actually Savitz can play again.
Yeah, he's unbenched. Show, though, with the Hybrid Hunter here, with the Wolf Riders.
It's a very cool version that Show plays. It plays also like the Tigers.
Whoa, melee lock. It's not hand lock. We lied, man.
You never know, man. You never know.
It's a dragon lock. This is... Whoa.
Yeah, I really like Dragon Warlock nowadays, or Malley Ghost Warlock, Malley Lock. I think it definitely has its weak points. For example, you can draw really awkwardly. If he never gets a dragon, this Blackwing Corruptor is just a worse Lost Tall Strider beast. And if you end up drawing too many situational cards, you also have just really no board impact. But that's like the nature of any combo deck, right? The reason why I love it, though, is it synergizes so well, once again, with the Warlock Hero Power. And there's a lot of cool opportunities to get really good synergy. Even just with like how Twilight Drake interacts with everything else, too. I really like this deck a lot.
But the biggest weakness of it is Hunter. It's like what I heard. It's like by far the weakest matchup. So it's like very good if like Liquid expected them to go Warlock. It's like,
Well, I really loved playing around with the Malley Lock, where you actually play Demon Wraths if you don't expect that many Warlocks. It's like the one circumstance. Like, I played Bloodmage Thalnos with Demon Wraths and the Coils. Mm-hmm. So it gave you like a bit more flexibility for removal against Hunter boards.
See, here's the awkward thing. It's like, well, do I play a Twilight Drake and give up my Blackwing Corruptor synergy? Or do I just, like, forego a weaker play on the board here? So many possibilities. Both, that's, like, kind of the awkward thing about this deck sometimes.
Yeah, I feel like the you have to go for the Drake, though, no?
Another thing is, right now, Shu doesn't really know for sure it's Dragon Lock, right?
True.
He saw a Zombie Chow, it can still be Hand Lock, a Twilight Drake. This point, you don't know.
Does that stop you, though? Does that truly stop? Gar, search... deepest part of your heart. That actually
does a Hunter get stopped? Yeah.
the only thing is, like, if you play around Molten Giants, that's the only thing, and that's what he's thinking right now.
So Shadow Flame is probably maybe Shadow Flame is a bit of a worry, a little bit too. Like, if you don't kill that Drake, there's that.
Okay, right. If he's if you know for sure this is Malley Lock, there's no way he would consider to play around Molten Giants.
Right.
But he has another bow, right, as well. Mm. But all he saw right now was a Zombie Chow, a Twilight Drake. Was it a coil as well?
No, not even a coil. He's seen basically nothing at this point. He knows
and Strifecrow is really famous for Handlock. Like, he's one of the best Handlock players. He's like, oh, please be Malley Lock. Because putting him on 6 life is the worst life to put...
you don't want to put him. Well, I mean, you don't want to put him too low. Is the problem if you think
he's playing around Molten Giants, he's clearing the board. If he would just go face, he would just win the game next turn.
Kind of playing around two things, and his hand has been very slow so far. So you have to assume there's something.
And he doesn't know yet. Like Sludge Belcher, if he plays Sludge Belcher, it doesn't say anything either.
Yeah, it feels like Sludge Belcher gets easily bullied though because of the trades with the Haunted Creeper and the. The Leopard Gnome here.
You're just saying, like, if you can avoid playing the Corruptor, just to give him, not to give him the information, you know? He might keep playing around Molten Giants, which is...
Show would be like, hey guys, it's Handlock.
if he plays
Instead cards,
like,
Belcher,
it was like, good job, Show. And then Strifecrow just whips up Malley Ghost later on. Like, what
happened there? So far, Dark Bomb, well played.
That's what makes it so annoying, too, and why I was even more floored that Valuetown didn't end up bringing Warlock. And it's just a little unfair to peg that as their only, you know, error or something. There's probably a lot of other things, too. But Warlock has pretty much every type of archetype short of Fatigue that's viable in Conquest, I think. And it's like, there's just so many things that's versatile with this class in general.
Yeah.
It's crazy, right? Even like when you just think about Malilock, there's like 10 different Malilock versions. It's insane.
10?
Yeah.
Really? Yeah. It's like
people play Molten Giants, one Molten Giant, all sorts of things. They cut the Corruptors. Like Noxious says, you play Talnos. Like,
they cut the Corruptors? Cards.
Yeah.
Like it's like a dragon. Molten...
they cut the Maligos and they put...
No, no. You play Maligos without the Dragon Synergy.
Bro, Dan. You're being facetious.
No, I haven't seen people really cut a lot of those cards.
They experimented with a lot.
Really. Like the people who climb to like top 5 legends and stuff, they play really weird decks.
Yeah, that's true. Well, I mean, you would know. I never get that far.
Because it catches you off guard. Just having like random Molten Giants in Malilock, because nobody plays around it, right? And people know that. So
yeah, I mean, that's what ladder is, being one step ahead of people and just like confusing them. That's why whenever someone posts a list, it's like the most weird stuff ever. And it's like, yeah, you got number one because no one knows what the heck you're doing. You don't even know what the heck you're doing sometimes. It's like you're playing random tech cards and it just happens to work.
Yeah, I played this Mana Wraith Shaman. It kind of worked out because, you know, I have a hero power that spawns minions.
He went for the hero power. He manned up.
So, well, Mikael with the coil, is that everything with Earthling Farseer?
Again, if he drew a dragon, I think he would have been in an okay-ish spot. Blackwing Corruptor and the Mortal Coil, but his deck definitely has its moments where it's less than perfect. See if he can draw something else here to help him. See, now Implosion's also awkward against Hunter 2 for another reason, the Unleashed Hounds. Do you want it to do maximum damage sometimes? I think it's like, if I have to kill this exactly, I want it to be 2. And I think that's the only instance where you want Implosion to be less than that outside of like Frothing Berserker combinations and patrons.
And this Leoc is actually surprisingly effective here. It's like, it's not a big enough threat on its own to justify really going all in on killing, but it's also giving the Hunter a little bit more reach with those minions. He's been spawning quite a few of them. Wow, nice juggle. Was that like a perfect outcome?
I think he'd prefer to, I think that'd be better because that way he doesn't have to lose a dog onto the board. Mm-hmm. So anything that Gaze puts out, I think he's also gotten to the point where he can deduce that his opponent doesn't have any, like, big threat like Molten Giants. And I think if I'm Strifeco and I know that I'm probably going to lose, I'd opt instead to forego that. But another thing that is nice is that he can, kind of stabilize on the board if he Implosions and Soulfires, but he dies to just the damage burn that's following up here.
I feel bought Soulfire is not too bad, right? I mean, it puts you on 16, then you remove Leoc. I mean, you're losing Soulfire, which is a big deal, but if you manage to stabilize after that point, like on turn 8, Implosion and Defender is pretty sweet. Mm-hmm. So
I feel like that's... I wonder. Yeah, that actually might be the only play then.
Yeah, this is really...
He has to lose a Corruptor. Basically, Soulfire needs to get rid of the Corruptor and it's going to be golden.
I don't know if that's like the winning play. Yeah, I don't know if that's the winning play either, like going for Healbot and Soulfire. It feels like a survival play.
Mm. Wow, that's convenient. And he actually rolled a 2, so minimizing the amount of... it doesn't matter here, but it could have mattered.
Ripping pepperonis.
Yeah, ripping the pepperones.
So, Sho has the damage to kill him.
He has 10 damage, so it's like...
I think he was just, maybe he had like some camera issue because it seems like it's frozen.
Yeah.
Sometimes you kind of just tunnel vision a bit. Like, alright, what if I trigger those imps? Oh wait, lethal.
He's like enjoying the moment. He's like...
Living in the moment, but that's gonna revive some beats though, that Hunter versus Warlock match.
Yeah, well done. It's tied 2-2 now. Liquid gets back onto the board. And that's a win each for Sho and Nyria. And Strifecrow, it was his first appearance, ends up dropping here. Now, Savitz, like you said, can come back anytime now that it's been unlocked. He's been unbenched. But is it the time to bring him out, considering that some of the classes available are still pretty strong? But the important thing is, like you said, if Klento is bringing Freeze Mage, the fact that Savitz is also still relevant with that druid is important.
It's like the one deck that I think really could punish that. I mean, it's I wouldn't want to be running up against. Oh, then again, Headlock is also not that bad of a matchup. Actually, wait, question: does Sho even know it's Malilock? Soulfire.
Yes,
sells it out. Yeah, the Soulfire and the Blackwing Corruptor.
Yeah, you're right.
Yeah, he discarded the Corruptor, so it's 100%. Druid is good against it, right?
Yeah,
so,
you could play Druid here and, you know, run into Freeze Mage or Handlock. I mean Malilock, and you'd be okay-ish. It's just that the other 50% are not what you want to face.
This really looks like they're trying to get that win on the Druid, the way how they played it, right?
Yeah.
Keep sending the Druid out.
Like, you'll die. Okay, you as well. It's like the mid-range Paladin syndrome.
He's unmatched. Let's send out the Druid again.
Yeah. I mean, they could try.
Gotta get that win.
I think there's like different levels of getting wrecked. There's like the, oh, I lost a lot of games, but whatever. And then there's like, I lost a lot of games with this one deck.
Yeah.
Like, I lost 0-6 with like Druid, for example. And then you're just like, wow. And you have this like thing where you just never want to play it ever again because you just, it's like that's, it just gets completely cornered and you couldn't beat their entire lineup with it.
Yeah.
So I think it's happened before, though.
It's just one of the super disheartening, right? When you get that one deck that you, like, it's a pretty average deck, so you would expect average results at worst. Like, the worst case scenario, you're going to pilot it, you know, 50%. You're like, all right, it's all right. But when you just lose straight up 4 or 5 games with it, that's just disheartening.
I experienced such a thing.
The Hunter, Gaara, Hunter.
Yeah. You might think, man, just one game. Come on.
Yeah, come on, fair RG. Enough, fair enough.
One game, come on. No.
I think I'm comfortable with almost anything here. I think all four classes you can make a case of like a bunch of mind games for. So pretty much whatever they feel like is the best for their strategy. So if Cloud9 doesn't want to bench Strifeco or get Strifeco benched at all.
I like Rogue a lot.
Then I would... Yeah. I was just saying from Cloud9, I think sending Kalento Recop here is perfectly fine too. There's like really not that many bad matchups for this Hunter, I feel. Assuming that's Patron Warrior.
That's kind of the strength of the best of 11, too. Like, with 6 decks, you're bound to be covering a lot of your dead angles. It comes down to those last few decks, really, where you will definitely notice. Like, if you do a best of 5, send Conquest between 2 players, you'll be realizing who has the edge matchup-wise. And that's kind of where it starts being relevant, like, in the best of 11. When there's, like, 3 decks left on each side, then you look at the lineups, and it starts to make a bit more sense.
Yeah, it's difficult for me, like, to rate Malilock, actually. Like, what are the really good matchups? It's so such a weird deck to rate.
It's
like,
how really, good is it against really, Rogue? Really good against Handlock.
Mm-hmm.
For example, if Maria goes Rogue against it, like, how good is it? It can be really good, but is it, like, super favorite?
No, actually, I don't like Malilock too much against Rogue. I haven't liked it, but I think it comes down to when you get the defender, and if the Rogue just whiffs on AoE. Like, you really need to get proper timing on those. Very often, I haven't found it necessarily very convincing.
It's good against Priest.
Right. What's not good against Priest? Oh, wait.
It's good Zeus. Against very, very slow.
Oh, snap.
Wow. Nox is jumping on the Gaara Hatred. Welcome aboard.
Yeah, having okay, fun. Gaara, we love you.
Ecop versus Sho. Okay, the Hunter here is what we thought would come out from Cloud9, but the Warrior was potentially Liquid just being a step ahead. I feel like maybe that's the case here because Liquid feels like they conveniently got the right side of the matchups against Strifecro, and sending the Warrior out here from Sho is also
it's pretty good.
Yeah. If this is a face Hunter, that is. I mean, I think out of all the decks that are there, maybe Rogue has the best chance against mid-range Hunter and Warrior has the best chance against face Hunter.
Yeah, that seems to make sense. I mean, it's in line with what pretty much everybody agrees on, I think, at this point.
It also depends on how you build the Patron, right? If you have the slow version with shield blocks.
Yeah, that could actually help. Like, the ghouls is pretty much, it's become more standard. Like, for a while, a lot of people were debating over them, but you see them a lot more now.
It's so, this is for me the funniest thing. How that cycles out. First, everyone cut their inner rages, and then everyone said, like, oh, yeah, inner rage is the best card. How can you cut that card? And then everyone cut Grommash, and then people were like, are you stupid? How can you cut Grommash? It's 10 damage for 8 mana. And then it comes back into the deck, and that same happened for ghouls, right? At some point, everyone cut ghouls.
Yeah, like, they're like, oh, I already have such a bad card.
And then it came back. Now it's like staple. Oh my god, how can you cut ghouls?
Yeah. Like, well, why would pirates. I not want whirlwinds in my deck? Like, yeah. I want six whirlwinds.
It's so fucking funny.
By the way, I got a question. Do you think Strifecrow was running an acidic swamp ooze in that Malilog deck?
Oh, we haven't seen it, but it's very likely. Yeah. In all types of Warlock, like even if it's Demon, Zoo, or Handlock, everyone likes to run one ooze now because you kind of have that one flexible spot. And it seems to, the card to go right now.
Big question is, will one day anybody make a legitimate pirate deck and then run the Bloodsail Corsair for Weapon Hate?
If anyone is going to do it, it will be Xixo.
Yeah, I was going to say, Xixo could probably pull it off. Like, he's done pirate more than most people I've ever seen.
Yeah. Makes sense. All right, well, the Hunter off to a very slow start. That's because it is the mid-range. We saw that Hunter's Mark, right, and the high main here. Mm-hmm. So it seems like it'll definitely be a slower mid-range approach. And against the Patron, generally speaking, the mid-range Hunter has been getting an edge recently. But that usually requires you to curve out very nicely. Like, you hit the strong animal companion, they can't answer it. You hit Houndmaster, you hit, like, Lotheb into high mains. Like, then you just completely overwhelm them. In this scenario, though, it's definitely gotten a little bit rockier, considering that Warrior has been able to stabilize early game, and he still hasn't even had their weapons yet.
Yeah, but that's a really good follow-up, though, from the Hunter player. Like, this is... Ecop's going to be able to silence off the Acolyte. Denying the draw here, I think, is really clutch.
Yeah, for sure. Wonder how much of a factor cards like Harrison will be here, because it's another one of those things where we saw it yesterday, and we've seen it in previous tournaments very recently, where it's like you have Harrison, which is great against Hunter, but then do they ever really draw weapons, or is there a scenario where you can really drop Harrison and get value outside of just being a 5/4?
Oh wow, that is not gonna pay off at all.
Yeah.
Well, you never know, right?
She really wants to get the better rage value, but right now it seems very difficult.
That's horrendous, actually. And if you play the weapon because it feels like the only safe-ish play, then it just gets hard countered right away.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Would you want... like, okay, is he attacking with the Deathbite next turn no matter what? Because if he is...
Not necessarily.
But if he isn't... you can use something like Animal Companion to bait it out and then drop the high main the following. Because this is a high priority elimination now. It's like you can't take 6 damage extra per turn.
And for the Hunter, you really want to force him to use the Deathbite before he draws the Patrons.
Yep.
So he doesn't have that. So like even if you sacrifice a minion like Animal Companion, it's still worth it.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Wait.
He's going to Battle Rage.
Battle Rage for 2 cards right here, get himself a bit of cycling. Oh.
2 slams. Wow, super cycle heavy. I've been seeing the 1 slam. Is 2 slams common as well now, Garo?
That's also another thing. First everyone caught it, and then everyone started to play 1 slam. I personally don't like 2 slams, but a lot of very good Patreon players play 2 slams.
Like it all comes down to your playstyle.
Lifecoach plays 2 slams. I think that Shio plays 2 slams. Maybe Salai as well. Yeah, he also plays 2 slams. Which is interesting. The cut feels so clunky sometimes.
Jaime's going to hit the face this turn. And that's a lot of follow-up pressure with Lotheb to shut down spells. I'm sensing that this is like a 3-step push here from Ecop. The first is just set up with damage. The second is to press for the win. And third is just to laugh at your opponent while thanking him.
Ladder style.
Yep, ladder style. Oh, I hate those people sometimes.
If there would be like statistic, like which class BM the most in game,
I'd say mage, sure. Man.
Yeah, like no, which class you think says me, thank you the most? It has to be Hunter.
Really? Like, I don't have that experience. The most.
It has to be Paladin, right? It's like it's statistically true. Like there's no way. It's just, yeah.
Well, man.
Smell what?
These are the facts of Hearthstone.
I don't know, man. Like, mages seem to me to be... like, I guess Hunter says Greetings Traveler the most when they get double Leprenome opener. Like, that is 100% greetings traveler statistic.
Yeah, but see, that's situational. Mm-hmm. Like, there's situations where you use greetings, but there's also situations where you use thanks and sorry. But for Paladin, every situation is okay to say well met. Yeah. There's no wrong time to use your greetings as a Paladin player.
It's true.
Is there? You're right. You name me one. You see, you can.
Yeah. You can die and say well met on the way out.
See? Okay, well, D-Cop's having an identity crisis. He doesn't know what he has to use here.
Wait, but no, it's like a bait. E-Cop is the hunter. But it actually looked like E-Cop was thinking.
Wow. All right, well, this is going to continue to put on a ton of pressure here. The warrior can win from here is to stabilize onto the board. But he doesn't even have, like, the Grim Page and Warsong Commander combination here.
Yeah, he's going to have to look for more AoE again. Oh, well, that's kind of helpful. In a way.
Yeah, no, it's definitely helpful. And with Armorsmith to follow up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this might actually be the turn where he starts to stabilize very, very well.
This is also like the life pool where, like, around where Patron stabilizes, around 10, 12.
Yeah. It's about average for them, right?
Yeah.
They're used
and then you get the Armorsmith out. And at that point, the Hunter is like out of removals for it. And then you start getting insane amount of health back.
Yeah. And then it's like there's one of these weird things where even if you roll Huffer, you still want to hit the face, but that Armorsmith is like staring at you with a nice juicy target on its back, and you're just like, hmm.
Yeah, if you
look, I think I like her a little better.
It's much worse against Patron than against Controller to let Armorsmith live, because they get much more armor.
Yeah, against Control Warrior, it's like you're worried about Sludge Belchers and maybe a Death Spite.
Yeah, Sludge Belcher is like, oh man, damn, why did I not kill that one?
Yeah, it's like four hits that you have to do separately. But that's the only scenario in this case. It's so awkward.
It's like full health back again.
How do you deal with the low step though?
Ooh, that feels so awkward. It's like no hero power that turn.
Oh wow, never mind.
Warsong Commander.
That'll do it on 9 mana.
Game.
Yeah. Hell, it's about time.
Yeah, it's heal a little bit of life here.
Does he want to? I guess he can also drop the frothing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Just collect some damage on it. It's still a little tight squeeze though. I think.
He might trade it away. I don't know. Do you dislike that?
Oh.
I mean, how does he handle your Warsong? And then past this point, you're pretty much gonna autopilot to victory if this board stays this way.
Yeah. You're right. It's too tough.
Oh wow, oh, never mind.
Dream. Are you ready, Gaara? Are you ready? Oh no. Dream died with Misha.
Everyone is still waiting for the double quick shot Dream.
No, it happened one time.
It happened, man. I think Shocky pulled it off. Was that
like,
Shocky or?
It happened one time. That's about it.
Yeah.
Everyone is trying to figure out, oh, there's still a way to get lethal. You just quick shot into Arcane Golem. Easy.
Sure.
But one day it's going to happen.
Yeah. In tournament to you. It's going to happen to you. Yeah. You're going to get punished by that for not believing it.
Yeah. That's how it works every single time. The more someone hates on a certain scenario or card, it just like ironically seems to mess them up the most.
Yeah. Sneasel, Shredder, Nosdormu. Welcome, life coach.
Yeah.
I wonder how many times Thais had to disbelieve the Sneasel, Shredder, Kel'Thuzad for that to happen, though.
Huh. I don't even know. By the way, there's an Inner Rage and a Grim Patron and a Warsong already sitting there, nice and pretty.
Yeah.
And
not sure about pretty, but yeah, I mean.
Oh, come on. Warsong Commander is beautiful in its own way.
Playing against Patron really feels like playing against the old Miracle.
Yeah.
Very strong, burly.
Just with a gazillion lives.
I think it's like the worst thing, because initially a patron wasn't as refined as it is now, and it used to feel like you were playing Freeze Mage when you played it. Like you had this long-term combo thing that you tried to set up and you drew a lot like Freeze Mage.
Whoa!
And then this happens.
Alright.
I don't even know what to say. 10, 14, to the power 22.
17 damage.
He doesn't care if it's lethal. He's like, hero, sir.
Wow. Take that. An E-Cop is somewhat crushed, man.
Yeah, it's like, greetings, sir. I just arrived. Everybody got in here. How are you feeling?
I don't think there's a combination of draws that can really pull him out, too, because Houndmaster was supposed to maybe taunt a minion, but his opponent had a board that got way out of control. So Sho takes two games in a row for Liquid, and E-Cop drops his game here.
And Sho's still undefeated is what it means, right? I don't think he lost.
He's done, right?
Yeah, he's done. And that means he's like 2-0 again, so another undefeated player to the Archon Team League at this point. Wow.
Yeah, well done for Liquid. They're also back into the lead here, giving Savit some breathing room. The Hunter is still around, though, and I think that was still the worst possible matchup based off what we're looking here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Actually, Rogue still can be problematic, too. Never mind. So I guess we're back to the drawing board. Pick whatever you feel like is good for your strategy.
I feel like it will come down to the Druid again, right?
Yeah.
To get a win on that. They tried.
Oh, that sixth deck. You know, this is the excruciating part. You cut one deck from this, and you're looking at a lineup that's just strong all around. And then you have to, if you have to smash a sixth deck into the lineup, then everything starts kind of looking flimsy. Like, you wish you could duplicate that Warlock.
I would still be feeling confident with Savish on the Druid, though. I mean,
yeah, as a pilot, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, do you think anybody could bring Priest and do well? Like, do very well. I mean, like, it's really complicated because...
I know that you're not trying to be mean to Garo, but it's just really funny that you're asking him directly.
That's right.
Well, he played Priest...
Can anybody
just yesterday, though. It's only like...
Is there anyone? Entire scene? Anyone? Maybe just one
Yeah, I mean, you brought it, and you played it a long time ago. It's like one of the classes I see you play like quite frequently that other players just don't bring. But it just doesn't feel super consistent either way, right? Yeah. I guess Kalento is like the only other player alongside you.
Kalento also brought it yesterday and won. So, and we're not talking about how bad Priest is in that context. Actually won the first game he brought Priest. And I think he won a really tough matchup. I feel like he beat Rogue. Or maybe beat Drew and
we both played it in HTC and we have lost with it, and we had bad matchups all the time, like against Handlock, against Rogue.
Yeah, if you get a good card draw, I guess you can always do somewhat well.
That's why you gotta put Mind Blasts in your deck, man.
What's the adaptation you have to make to really compete in the like against those guys, like against Patron metagame, let's say? Because very often I think you just get comboed down at unfortunate times.
But if they don't draw Emperor, it's one card you have to draw, right?
Right.
And the thing is, with Cabal, you will always steal something good. If you steal an Armorsmith and you Thought Steal an Armorsmith, you already have two Armorsmiths. And then, like, doing 60 damage, you need to draw your entire deck. And it's like, everyone jokes about it's so easy, right? But drawing your entire deck, you have to get to that point, and you only run two executes. You can't execute a Valens Chosen Target and then execute a Cabal. It's like those minions, like... Harrison, Loatep, you can't execute everything.
So it's like mid-range minions that just tempo you down eventually. Kind of like Druid when they get the curve.
That's why Quartermaster, for example, is very good against Patron. You can't kill all that stuff. You don't run Brawl. Like, you need to survive till you can play your stuff. And Priest has very good bot removals for Patrons with Light Bomb, the Circle Auch and I. It's probably like the best class with a lot of removals for Patrons.
All right, well, hopefully we get to see a bit more of that in the next... few weeks of Archon. I mean, I'd love to see more priests. It's one of the classes that I think deserves a bit more representation. But then again, I guess you have to adapt to your players a bit more.
I guess, and it has like a lot of decent matchups. Like with Druid, you feel like, oh man, that's a bad matchup, that's a bad matchup, that's a bad matchup. But with Priest, it's like you like to play against any type of Hunter. You always feel like from the back in the days, you always feel like Priest was the counter to Hunter.
Yeah.
Like mid-range Hunter is still very good for Priest. Like, Priest can handle mid-range Hunter really well, and most people tend to bring that, not aggro. Mm-hmm. And, yeah, Patron is fine. And, like, Zoo is fine, you know, those aggro decks. Priest has
still
like,
great against mid range shaman.
Yeah, no, it's still.
Any four pool chooses to bring it.
It can happen.
Yeah. It might. I mean,
some of those. It's also,
hashtag Silent Storm.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Priest is also pretty decent, from my opinion, dealing with some of the tempo mage stuff too. But I don't know the actual statistics of it because people don't really play much tempo mage anymore.
The least played matchup. I think the only other least played or less played matchup would have to be like Echo Mage versus Priest.
Imagine how frustrating it would be if
Priest
you bring
is
Shaman.
Terrible against Echo Mage, man.
If you bring Standard Shaman.
It's like, well, I Shadow Word Death and he duplicated his Mooth Mountain Giant. It's like, oh god.
Yeah. Headlock all over again.
All right, well, here we go. Klento versus Savitz. Mage versus the Druid. That is the one matchup. That was actually the one matchup that they wanted to avoid.
Yeah.
Like, Freeze Mage against anything else would have been okay.
And Savitz here.
And I think that, on the other hand, Liquid really tried to get that matchup. That's why they're sending out the Druid so often. Like, you really want to face the Freeze Mage with your Druid, because that is one of those matchups the Druid is really favored.
Oh, see, yeah, if you can pick up a hand, it's going to help that. Because very often, even though you might be favored, you still have to play the tempo, like, very fast.
Yep.
To push them out. This is not quite the minion heavy hand the Druid wants to see.
Yeah. No, Wild Growth definitely stinks. But he still has a couple of interesting cards here. Mind Control deck will be dead, so you might as well just drop it. I think Druid's chances improve in this matchup based off of a few things. Like, he has good draws and Druid's got mediocre draws. The second thing is that Klento has the coin, so he can convert that into more damage, because that's part of the thing too, is like, now that he has Alexstrasza and Antonize in hand, he can start pressuring if he can find a way to go for a win here. So I think there's a couple of factors in Kalento's favor here. He can definitely take it. It's not a 100% to zero match.
Yeah, yeah.
Here. And this wouldn't be the first time in ATLC in recent memory that we saw Druid beat a Freeze Mage. Or Freeze Mage beat the Druid, excuse me, the other way around.
Yeah, I think even matchups are like 70%, you still can't expect them to go down to like as planned systematically. Mm-hmm. Like, there are some matchups like Freeze Mage versus Control Warrior, you kind of feel like you're sitting through a slugfest, but this is not one of them, really.
Huh. Second Keeper!
But yeah.
For the Doomsayer. Well.
Usually, like, you save the keepers for the Doomsayers. You can never ever lose your board as a Druid. Like, it's very crucial.
Yeah, but you still have to have a board, which I think why he ended up playing the first one. What he did.
But now, like, right now, you almost guarantee a board clear with the second Doomsayer. If you
I mean, Emperor, Archmage, yeah. Alex, Ice Lance, Frostbolt, Fireball. That's pretty
that's
good,
awesome.
Right?
He's gonna unnerf everything.
Yeah. Oh, wow. No. Never. Blizzard, please.
Also, what's really unfortunate about Savitz's hand is that he'd prefer to use things like Ancient of Lore to maybe heal as the time goes on, but because his hand's so situational and awkward that he has to use it to draw here.
Just the combo. Like, you really want the Vycroft as well, right? Just to get the combo out pressure before the Alexstrasza.
Yeah, that's
and
generally
to draw Lord Tap as well, obviously.
This like is a nice card. Box pop, actually, I think.
That this would be is, huge. Oh man, popping an Icebox this early is
then
insane.
The Thorsten stays alive, I think.
Does it matter? You have to swipe. You have to force.
No, you have to use swipe here in order to pop the Icebox.
Oh, yeah. 6, 8, 13.
Yeah, you have to.
Yeah.
You can put him down to one, though. That's a nice thing.
But you don't lose your board. And you can still.
Yeah, what can you do for 7 mana?
I think it's worth it, though.
I think so, too, considering that you have Force of Nature from the hand to burn.
Yeah, to go for it again.
But if the thing is, he doesn't know if it's. Does he know it's Ice Block? Yeah, he knows, right?
Yeah, he's already attacked into it to see if it was Ice Bear. So, like, he's fully aware that he's going to be able to force his opponent to replay a secret if he's got it.
And Alexstrasza is 8 mana, so he knows that as well.
Even with the Emperor play, it's still not enough.
Also, like, because at this point he has to use defensive Alexstrasza, so he doesn't need to save the low for heal.
Oh.
As well.
So what's he do here? He has to ice. That's like the one card that could have helped him if Savage doesn't pick up any like direct damage.
No, that was such a huge draw. He knows his opponent uses a swipe and two keepers. That's I think the only other way you can do direct damage without using the ice barrier is the second swipe. Unless I'm missing something. Mm. Unless a Ragnaros comes out of nowhere.
Wow, Baron Geddon. There you go.
At some point you will be able to do some crazy Alexstrasza plus Blizzard turns. If this keeps going here.
Yeah. No, he's very close to getting craziness happening. Like, it's just a matter of living.
And he has Antonidas as well. Like, some really crazy stuff.
He might not need it, though.
He has to Nova here or he's dead.
The 5 damage might add up. Like, from Emperor alone, that might just be enough to start punching for direct damage.
That's a big deal as well.
Oh. Okay.
What is he doing?
He's just removing the board. Oh, is he playing around another Silence on a minion?
What are the odds? Wailing Soul Druid is gone. Like, it lives for all of a week.
That's interesting.
Even then. Oh, wow. Alright.
This is so weird to see that from the Freeze Mage, right? Playing like this.
Yeah. Normally, you just, like, he pushes. But he was going on the off chance his opponent had, like, an Iron Beak Owl or something.
Yeah, that was weird, right? Like, I feel like if he went for Phase, I kind of criticized his Freeze Mage Dreamhack Bucharest. Because he's... in those situations, because like he will, like the way to win as a Freeze Mage is to burst down your opponent, and how it looks like he has to play Alexstrasza defensively, right? Or he's dead. So you need the damage. You will just run out of cards. Like he just used both Ice Lances without Antonidas. He will just run out of damage.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking too. But we'll see what he's like. What his longer game plan is, because I really feel the way you do. Right.
Yeah.
So.
The funny thing is about Alexstrasza, it's like, he doesn't have a BGH, he can't kill it.
Yeah, Alex can make up some of that damage too, and there's like, Antonidas, Frostbolt, Blizzard next to... Oh, I guess he's gonna use Frostbolt now, stop to make sure it preserves some health.
You have to Frostbolt first.
Easiest wow. Could this have been
that
huge?
That can get it out of hand. Oh, well, he doesn't have 10 mana. If he had 10 mana... That mana wraith could have gotten super big, or whatever it's called, mana addict.
I'm surprised Kalento killed the mana, the shredder after he played Alex.
Yeah, he's doing small misplays.
Yeah, but it's kind of like putting the shredder in the middle, right? Like RDU brings it up, and then you realize it's gonna be something you just harp on forever. But
no one was doing it yesterday. Yeah. Everyone was putting shredder on the outside. I guess he cycles.
I'd imagine, yeah, he does.
You can't really kill it anyways. Mm-hmm. But check this out! Antonidas Blizzard!
Easy.
I'm pretty sure that's game.
Yeah, easiest Antonidas Blizzard of his life.
Pretty sure that's game, because Alexstrasza is going to hit for 16, and then you have the 17, or 18, excuse me, from Antonidas. No, wait, no! You can put two, you can play three fireballs next turn.
It's like, where is your... Where's your keeper now?
Oh my god.
It's frozen and shattered.
This game got really wonky thanks to Emperor Thorsen.
I mean, is there anything, like, I guess a cycle BGH?
Yeah, BGH.
Like, BGH off this, you killed the Alex and you taunt up behind the Druid, but otherwise you just have to attack on it, but you know he's got at least one fireball.
I mean,
you don't know
one,
the rest, right?
But, yeah, this is. But he let Alexstrasza hit twice. It's like, it's a freeze mage.
Yeah, that's pretty bad here. That's going to be game. Cloud9 ties it up.
The Druid, with losing the one matchup, it actually wanted to pick up.
Savage still played really well. Like, it was correct to leave the Emperor. I mean, it went crazy afterwards, right? Because of what happened, but it was still correct to go for the pop block.
I agree. I think you can't really blame Savith in this situation, and it's unfortunate that now he's lost three. All three games that Liquid's lost has been on Savith, and I think the stress might be building up too. Savith is a player that is more emotional than some of the others.
Yeah, it's one of the things, I mean, really, like, it has to do something to you.
And really, what is really, really the most frustrating part is if you get a matchup which you want to get, Like, you want to face the Freeze Mage's Druid, right? And if you lose that, that is, like, really, really soul-crushing, and I wonder, like, how Savius is gonna, like, handle it. I mean, yeah, you get the matchup you want to get, right? And then you lose that matchup. That's, like, more crushing than just losing any matchup.
Yeah, and you really, like, mind-gamed yourself into trying to position it so maybe the opponents wouldn't put in Freeze Mage. Yeah, it's kind of one of those things where he knows he's gonna be at a disadvantage for the rest of the matchups if he ever picks up another one with Druid. So it can only feel like it's gonna get worse from here when you're gonna have to replay that deck.
Yeah. Well, you know, Klenta redeemed himself from last week. Last week, Klenta went 0-4. This week he is 2-0. So
yeah.
Klenta being able to swing the opposite momentum and get two wins very quickly, and I think he's happy to do that because we all know that Klenta's also been traveling to Korea, so it's been quite some time before he's been able to go home. In the meantime, we have Strifecrow with the Paladin and the Warlock with Ekop on the Hunter. I'm still feeling like it's okay for anything to come out here. Generally speaking, though, I think I like to see Nyria be able to come out here again, because I think Savitz being queued up once more lets him be benched, and then allows you to be cornered into like picking the best matchup against Rogue, and that's not what you want.
Well, the thing is, which of the matchups is exceptionally good against Rogue? I mean, Malilock,
Hunter?
Hunter is like the closest thing you're going to get to a really good matchup. So it's like,
and if you can, like, if Savitz is banned, you can really pick your Hunter into Rogue.
Yeah.
Which usually is not possible.
Do you think midrange Hunter is really favored against Rogue though?
I think it might even lose, but
even giving the edge to Rogue slightly.
I think the Law Tip is such a big deal, which you don't really think about it, just because it allows you to clear the Rogue. Like, you have to clear every turn Rogue's minion. That's like the most important thing, and midrange Hunter can do that. And it allows you to set up the Hymen and not lose to Zap. Like, Lotep is
okay, I know what you mean. So, like, you know what I mean? At least guaranteed a 5-5, and then you get a 6-5 that's also going to be hard to remove. So then the Rogue has to really get, like, she has to have had already a big weapon to Flurry, otherwise she's kind of out of it.
Yeah, and if you have this Hymen, a Rogue can't remove it. Like, if you can,
Lotep
survive to Zap.
Well, it's kind of like against Freeze Mage, right? Like, there's some matchups where it all comes down to Lotep being played in the mid game, like where you push for damage, or late game, let's say, after Alex to prevent the OTK. There's like two good spots, and against the Rogue, I guess, you know, if you have the high main, that's kind of your sweet spot as a midrange Hunter.
Yeah. Then it's just too much damage. Then oftentimes he's so low on life, just one kill command, whatever, is enough to just kill him. Easy.
That makes sense.
So we're predicting a Nyria Rogue.
I say probably.
If Cloud9 predicts this, they go with Hunter themselves.
And then they predict this, and then they go with the... Well, they still go with Rogue, don't they?
Well, yeah, I think the best choice here, on a lot of levels, is probably Rogue for Liquid, just to avoid Savitz to get benched here.
They want to dodge the Ekop, because Ekop is like, he's holding the gun on the entire lineup from Liquid at the moment.
Yeah, if I looked at Ekop's face in this picture and you told me he's holding a gun, I'd probably believe you.
Fitting.
Right. He's got really that cold light Oracle crazy look.
It's like the rumble.
There's a little screws loose in there.
there's a few problems with that guy. I wouldn't trust him with my child. All right. Oh,
I think that's a great babysitter ad.
I like the guy who's photobombing Sho.
You know what? I'm going to have to ask Ekop if I can use that picture in a fake babysitter ad. You know what? That would be the greatest thing.
It's 10 p.m. Do you know where your kids are? Strifecrow versus Nyria is coming up here. It's Warlock versus the Rogue. I feel like Rogue would be okay against this, but then I also think about cards like Twilight Drake and how problematic it is already for Rogue to deal with. And it's that there are threats, but they're not impossible to deal with Rogue. So I feel like it's definitely easier than it is against Handlock. And I already think Rogue is pretty decent against Handlock. So
yeah, the biggest part is really that you don't have the Molten Giant mind games, which you have against Handlock. I think in general, it's easy to play against Malilock, just because you It's like the biggest thing when you play around against Handlock, right? It's like the biggest difference.
Mm-hmm.
That you always know, are not sure, like, am I pushing now for damage? Do I play around Molten Giants? Like, when do I start playing around Molten Giants? And how much life do I keep him? And you don't have that against Mardulok. It's like a really big difference. You just go for it, you know?
I think, interestingly enough, like, Zoo and, you know, mid-range Demon is like the two more difficult Warlocks. Because otherwise, I think Rogue is doing very well against them. And even then, you're still maybe slightly favoring some variance against even those faster Warlock decks.
Also, the pressure from Handlock is much higher. If he gets the Giant out on 4, you have to kill it or you're dead in, like, in the course of 2 or 3 turns. But look, plays like a... Places like Imp Gangbus or something, you know?
Yeah, I mean, this is basically like, if you're the Rogue player, you just push for damage whenever you have it. Like, the only things that are gonna stop you are two heal bots, which anyway, Handlock also has. But there's the use there in the Warlock hand, so that could come in handy.
Yeah, but again, I think, it's like we always mention, the Blade Flurry here won't necessarily be... Actually, against... Wow, 4 on the... Violet Teacher kind of stinks for the Rogue. But I think against Warlock specifically, though, Rogue is more inclined to camp than against other classes. So that could be useful.
That was such a huge implosion.
I think that it's also huge that you follow up with Blackwing Corruptor. The amount of tempo you gain on the board through Implosion for 4 and Blackwing Corruptor on curve...
That
like,
is insane.
For full value. It's just nuts.
I don't even know what to say. Like what?
The difference
is so hard to come back.
The difference between like getting a 2 or 3 or 4 is ridiculous when you put it.
If you think about it, it's like the same play twice, except they just spread it out. So Implosion creates 8 stats and does 4 damage and just spreads it out. And then this does 3 damage but 9 stats all in one body.
It's
just like such a
game.
Huge swing for Malik. I mean, like now it's like Emperor Thorazin comes down pretty easily. And
I actually wanted to bring that up early when we were talking about Maligos Lock. Like, I think that it's whenever I watch this deck being played, it really comes down to Implosion luck. Like, because it changes so much, like, the entire curse of the game. Like, in this situation, like, he had no answer for Violet Teacher, and suddenly he had, like, the best answer.
Yeah. Actually, is this even a good hand for Emperor Thorazin? It's not very powerful, now that I look at it. Like,
the thing is, but the thing is, it should be difficult to kill. Like, he just used the spell power. And usually, like, 5 toughness is one of the sweet spots. Everything that has 4 health just gets eviscerated. But, so there's a chance it survives. And that's, like, where you, like, there's 2 ways of playing Emperors. You play it with, like, a good quality, hand quality. Yeah, and another way is, there's a chance it survives. And if it survives, it's just absolute nuts.
Yeah, too much tempo being gained through the mana reduction.
But I kind of feel like very often in Malilok, you're really trying to push for that extra, you know, Maligos synergy. Like, he's got the Hellfire and the Coil at least.
Yeah.
Is it going to be worth it? But like, a 4-mana Drake is nothing to scoff at. Like, 3-mana Defensive Argus again.
But one of the sickest parts are not even... It's like the Coil with Maligos.
Yeah, like 6 it's damage so- straight up.
It's so huge.
Sap on Antonitus.
That's
Antonitus. Oh man, please don't give the Warlocks Antonitus. I am quitting this game. I am out.
Sorry, not the Antonitus, the Thors.
No, of course. I know what you meant.
I mean, and that is huge for Strife Crew, right? So he knows there was no answer for it. So he gets like another turn of Emperor. It's like really sick. Like, that's why it was so worth it to play the Emperor last turn.
Yeah, now you get Mortal Coil for 2, and you get to draw.
Yeah, and he can still life take.
Yeah, because, you know, why not? Why not?
I just played 20 mana. I'm just going to life take. Oh, man, this looks so bad for Naria just because of the Emperor. Because he will get... Now he can choose the second Emperor. He got already so much value out of it.
Yeah, if he now throws he it just as a throwaway, like, he doesn't even care about it anymore. Oh wow.
Oh,
and the Maligos gets picked up.
That is what you want to reduce.
Yeah, but there's one Soulfire, never mind. I was gonna say there's no like big damage spell like Dark Bomb.
Well, there's Hellfire.
Yeah, I mean that's a lot of face damage.
But it only becomes 3 mana. You're right. It's not actually that impactful. Mm-hmm.
It's like you kinda wanna wait for the Dark Bomb, because you have Maligos already, so you can wait out on that Emperor to really just get maximum lethal possibility with it.
Well, this also sets up, you know, an equally big board, or not like a better board, and you can protect the Emperor if you can't deal with this efficiently. He already used a sap. He's going to have a second one, exactly. And
I like this Dr. Boom, though, in the rogue.
Well, I feel like this might be an opportunity for Hellfire, but at the same time, it's not even that great, considering that it kills off your own Defender of Argus.
Weapon seems like the ooze seems sort of interesting, because I mean, even if you just kill Lotheb with the Defender, that's enough. Like, the Hellfire again is maybe a bit of an overpaying for the effect you get out of it.
Yeah,
if you're going to lose enough. The Defender anyway,
maybe you just play Drake, trade the Lotheb. Like, you just go back to building the board again. Thing is, you can't even set up like a two-turn kill either, because you only have 2 points of burn, like you mentioned, and Hellfire plus Soulfire is only 17 damage from what I count.
I think the tempo is going to be good enough to really threaten Nerea here.
Okay, so this is a
big tempo turn.
Yeah, a Shadow Flame play. Okay. Perfectly fine if he just wants to start getting, you know, ways to peck in there. And now he can set up so that if these minions do a little bit of damage and control the board, then he can play Emperor Thorsen and then he can go for a kill the following turn. So this is a 3-turn plan here from Strife Crow.
It's gonna get slowed down a bit by the heal bot, but not that much really. Oh wow.
Oh my goodness.
Strife Crow with the pickups.
That's so big. Yeah. And the Boombots are not even that good against Imp Gang boss too, because the 1/1s that spawn.
Yeah, he will probably just attack with the Imp Gang boss first. Hope to get.
Oh no,
he's lost. Dead.
Oh, that sucks. Dead.
So what does he do with that other little Boombot?
There's nothing you can really do against it, right? Yeah.
You still fire it. I mean, that's the obvious answer.
I think it's time to set up for the lethal. You have 17 damage from the Malygos on the following turn. You might even pick up Dark Bomb.
I don't even know if there's like any combination of cards Rook can have. Double Isle.
Well, it would have to be like Prep Sprint into Oil Blade Flurry specifically, because that's exactly 10 mana and it sort of wipes the board with the Boombot. But it's like, get lucky, mate.
Even if he had Blade Flurry just off instead of that prep, it would have been enough to clear the board here.
Mm-hmm. Well, nice Boombot.
It's so funny that Boombot's always go for the BGH, right? Is it just
me?
It always goes for the BGH.
Oh man, don't start with the dad stuff, chat. The chat, my chat experience. It's dead.
It always goes for the BGH.
Dad is dead. Stop bullying dad.
Yeah.
Well,
I pretty much think he's forced to play everything, right? Yes, but the thing is, he can't. He was hoping to kill off the BGH, I guess, so that way he can deadly poison SI the Emperor and then just heal bot.
Like, the heal bot could slow things down if the boom bots weren't so bad.
Yeah, but I think Nyria knows that there's a strong chance that he's dead here. Actually, he's 1 point up? No, he's 1 point
with
down.
No, with that, he's dead. Yeah.
So that should be it. Strife Crow. Barring any really poor sequencing, like getting too ahead of himself and soul firing before Hellfire and discards it, that would end up being the match here.
The and old means, Warlock life.
4-3.
Yeah.
I wonder if anyone ever killed himself accidentally with a 8 damage Hellfire. I haven't seen
it has to happen. Like
three damage Hellfire sometimes by not paying attention.
Nice.
Eight.
It's more likely the frostbolt in your own face.
Oh man.
Yeah, for
Remember
sure.
Remember that eco-op game?
Well, that was Klento's first win, I believe, which means the only person that hasn't been able to get a win is Savitz so far.
Yeah. Well, I mean, Nerea still has to win the rogue, but the matchups that are ahead of him are still kind of okay. Like, it's like it still comes down again to that druid. Like, what's it gonna do against paladin? that's pretty rough against Hunter. That could also be rough, but at the same time, you could pull it off against, I think, Hunter almost more comfortably
than Paladin. Pretty even matchup, Paladin versus Druid.
So yeah, it's kind of a... Then again, like, he hasn't gotten an unfair one. Like, no unfair start, which is usually what carries you. Like, you can play against any deck as Druid, you get an unfair start. Like, they very often do with a single Wild Growth start, and then you can't stop them. It doesn't matter what you do, but all the games that he's played so far have been kind of on the slow side of things.
Yeah, I think so. Well, I guess now we come down to either the Paladin and the Hunter up against these classes, and I think Hunter is really safe to go from here. I think you want to give as many chances to the Paladin as possible. Paladin can beat Rogue. I mean, Rogue can beat itself, and top of Paladin can curve out really well. Assuming this is the mid-range or a control Paladin. If Strifeco is playing aggressive Paladin, then he's in a great spot, honestly.
Yeah. If you can think that far ahead, like as a team, and you have that spot, and then everyone expects you to play control.
Wow, that is pretty next level from Cloud9 to like make it seem like.
And then you have like Paladin. The most aggressive Lepronome Paladin.
It's like Lepronome Paladin. Hobgoblin with wisps and stuff, and you're like, wow, I thought this deck died 4 months ago.
Whistle yeah, Hobgoblin Paladin all of a sudden.
That's right.
Then you get owned.
It'd be fun though. I mean, it's one of those things like it lived for what, 2 weeks? And then it just faded away.
And only Savish played it. Like in
yeah, games. He's the only player who brought it. And I think he did, like, he got a few wins, and then he retired it, like, just to say, hey, you know what, I came in with this funky deck, and I took a few wins, look at how good it was, now I'm out. I'm never playing it again.
That's well, he actually kinda... brought it to several tournaments. He brought it to, like, Seed Story, he brought it to ESL, and he has, like, a 60% win rate with that deck. It certainly wasn't the weak link. I think it just became a little, like, too predictable, so he started playing other stuff. And then, you know, it's just since moved on because Hobgoblin Paladin is, like, inferior to, like, some of the other decks that are out there that are really aggressive. But it was really interesting to see it do well.
It's kind of sad that it a little bit died out compared to back in the days last year.
Actually, I think that is one of the few cases in Conquest this year where we've had one deck that's just iconic to a player.
Yeah,
like
yeah.
Every other deck, I feel like that's gotten popular has been used by so many people. But Saviz was literally the only player that
Mech
was
the Warrior player. Life Coach. That's the other one I've got.
Oh yeah,
that's okay. Like the only other one maybe.
There were only like also very few people that played Fatigue Mage. I think that only Colento and Saviz played it in tournaments. It's like one of those icons.
Chalky also did.
One tournament, Shrek, right?
Right. Big difference. It was like Mech Druid from Dog.
Also, Gar, didn't you play at one tournament?
Fatigue Mage?
Yeah. Oh, no. You played against Fatigue Mage.
It was against Savish.
Oh, my God.
It was against Savish.
Gar was really salty after losing to Fatigue Mage.
Yeah.
I would be too. Right.
No, man. Good times. But that's so cool. I think this is one of the coolest things in Hearthstone when someone has like an iconic deck.
Yeah, and no one else chooses to play it.
Yeah, like it's good and nobody else plays it. That's like awesome. Bloodlust Chairman.
No, it's even cooler if it's bad and he's the only one playing it and winning with it, right?
Yeah. That
is really cool.
Like Pirate with Bloodcell Corsair has to happen. Xixo, you're on it, right? He's got to be... Just waiting for that.
One day.
Yeah.
Or like Murloc Shaman.
Oh, man.
Murloc Lock.
Yeah.
Like Tides brought it as well. Like it was not bad, right? But nobody decided to play it in a tournament. Stuff like that is so cool.
So he's got the wild
and he won with it.
Right? So that could be the unfair start that he needs to really start pushing for tempo.
I don't know if this is intentional, but Savitz is... deck is teched very well against Paladin. He's got Mind Control tech, Harrison Jones. He's got like really good cards to fight back onto the board as after the Wild Growth too. So I think as long as he can stabilize once, maybe Paladin will try to come back again. But I think generally speaking, he has the tools, but can he keep up with the pace of the Paladin? Because after turn four, Shrefko has a true silver champion, but he still needs a little help to get to Dr. Boom safely.
Strifecore's deck is kind of scary because he ran Quartermasters last week, so it's like reasonable to expect that again. So you have to kill those 1/1s. It's like a different playstyle where you know you have to kill those 1/1s than to knowing he doesn't have Quartermaster and you can just ignore it. It's like you make your weaker plays automatically. Like if you know you can ignore the 1/1s, you might as well go for like Shades and stuff.
Yeah,
like
I see what you mean.
Claw. Mm-hmm. But now you just know you have to kill him.
Yeah, like if you play Shades, you don't do anything.
Yeah, it's true. But you do know that he doesn't have the coin because you have the coin, so you still have one more turn to deal with the 1/1s.
Right. Yeah, I mean, you could probably MC Tech. So, like, MC Tech is the equivalent of, you know, using two mana up to kill one, except you get a slight tempo boost out of it. Not a huge one, mind you, but...
Like, the thing is, if he gets, like, a Quartermaster on three or so Druids, it might be game over. Because Druids... usually can't deal with it.
Mm-hmm.
He has the MC Tech, but...
MC Tech... just like, so good against Dr. Boom sometimes. It feels like... Okay, Gaara, how many times has your Dr. Boom been stolen by an MC Tech?
Oh, not just Dr. Booms, man. MC Tech stole everything he wanted so far.
Oh, man. If there was a Quartermaster here... Wait, if there was a Quartermaster, this would be... excruciating, because you can't even MC Tech. Like, you have to Wrath.
Wow. It's such a random way to win a game with MC Tech.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's Hallfru's most hated card, I think, in Arena.
Like... no, he's all not right. Considering it.
Yeah, it's true. It is really swingy in Arena, for sure. Because it steals, like, the Boulder Fist Ogre every time. Every time.
I hear those words, like, it's... the worst thing is, my Boulder Fist, man. It can't do anything.
Dude, poor Boulder Fist. Joke, but Boulder Fist Ogre is some had lived some serious weight before, like, GVG came out. And, like, you know...
yeah.
Because that type of RNG is not fun. Because the difference of the outcomes is...
it's kind of fun. It's fun for me when I take the doctor.
Oh, when I play it, it doesn't do that. It just steals, like, the 1-1. Not the Boombot.
The Boombot's also really good, because then...
it doesn't take the Boombot.
Obviously, the mind control tech trades into Boom, and then you hit this Boombot, and you hit Dr. Boom for 4. It's a full board clear.
You know, I kind of like this play, just because if there's a True Silver, the normal thing happens. If there's a Quartermaster, you're at least killing two of those guys. So.
Yeah, the thing about True Silver, though, is that True Silver is set up and he still has a minion on board, so he can answer most likely whatever can come out for 5 health. There's no card in Druid that's a common rotation that's more than 5 health. So this 1-1 surviving, or even the zombie trap coming out, is a really big deal. Because it sets up for a safer Sylvanas, which sets up for a safer Dr. Boom.
Maybe the Shade is the reason he made that play, because that way he's got a minion that the True Silver will not take out, and he snap plays it, so maybe that was the reasoning.
Yeah, that could be a good point. But this also goes back to show you of, like, the ramifications of Strifecore consecrating just for, you know, three, just for, like, to kill off this 3-3 potential that can ever control the board here. So I think, like, a lot of this is the consequence of Strifecore planning his turns ahead of time.
Some looks bonus. Like Strifecore's favorite just because he has the Dr. Boom and Savish doesn't have the BGH right now. Man, that
he's
MC
got
tech,
the MC Tech, man.
It really might come down to the MC Tech RNG. I wonder.
Then we're going to get nerf MC Tech posts. It's toxic for the game.
Probably the worst minion to steal would be the Zombie Chow.
No, by far, yeah.
Don't
like,
give
hey, do you want 5 life? Here's a holy light for you. Take that.
Let's see. Strifecore has to also be thinking about the ramifications of playing like Sylvanas now versus loading up similar power on the board with Pilot Shredder and having something stick. And then that way, if he even has like Swipe and BGH or something like that to deal with his board, he'd be more resilient. Sylvanas is like the better guarantee board clear though, because then Shade can't sit here camping forever. And not to mention that, like, it also halts future development because, like, he can't just play Dr. Boom this turn, for example. Oh, which man, he could have if the pilot came out.
He picks up his own Dr. Swag now. And it's green. Yeah. Usually that's, like, an indication that you're playing.
I wish that Blizzard would make it orange actually on turn 7, because you know when it's orange,
you know,
it just
it's
tells
like
you
enabled.
That the game is like, okay, you probably should play this.
Like with some warning lights. It's like with a tooltip popping up. You
like
should play this card.
As you have.
This is like,
that would be the best like April Fool tooltip implementation. This, you just drew this card.
Oh, just get washed next year, man. It's happening.
You should
They're
play
gonna
it.
Be like. How long do you think it'll take before Dr. Boom is not a staple of a lot of mid-range decks anymore? Like, that's what
know,
I wonder very often.
There's just a few cards that are looming that will take its place that people will complain about.
Yeah,
you know, people like always make fun of the fact that they predicted Trogs were to be really good, and then they just got replaced by Dr. Boom. But if Trogs were ever got to the point where it was like Dr. Boom was bad and the meta was just slightly slow enough that Trogzor would be super dominant, people would be asking for the same thing. They're like, oh, I can't play spells. Where's the interaction in that?
Like Patron, right? What is the interaction in that?
Yeah, the point is people complain about everything. Another legendary will take place as the best legendary.
It could be a common. I mean, Undertaker style.
Sure.
Yeah.
That said, I hope Dr. Boom can die in a grease fire.
Well, at BGH, killing Dr. Boom, this mind control deck is just doing nothing. You kind of have to play the Hungry Dragon, right? At least the swipe is super effective.
Again.
Oh my god.
Oh, revenge.
Boomba's always killing BGHs.
Do it, Dad. Yeah.
But it gave time for Savitz to pick up the BGH for the Dr. Boom from Strivecrow, though.
Yeah, that's huge.
That's a really big outcome for him. Like, it's really important. And he gets, like, a perfect curve.
Wow.
Kills a 2-2. That's like...
That clear was insane.
Yeah.
And then, you know, maybe Strivecrow feels like the opportunity to play Dr. Boom. And then he plays Big Game Hunter. And then the Boombots kill the Big Game Hunter right back. This
Which
is how
will.
Wars started, ladies and gentlemen. It's just a nonstop revenge kill after revenge kill. Violence is not the answer.
Like in
never is.
Yeah.
Make love, not war.
The thing, the reason.
This cash has got really real. All right. Sorry, Gar.
Leon Hands is usually very difficult to develop against Druid.
Yeah.
And I feel like that was a good turn to play Leon Hands, just to get more options and stuff. Because if he has the BGH for the Dr. Boom, you will be behind on board, and how do you come back on board? It's impossible. You have not the cards, and then you're always like threatened by lethal from the combo.
Yeah, with a combo. So I see what you mean.
That's like because
check this out, Gar. Check this out.
Goodbye, Big Game Hunter. You will be missed. Although that second juggler is really going to make the muster for battle a lot better. Well, so far not really, but you know.
Just double click the second juggler.
Oh. Man. Oh, never mind that.
It's like every RNG hates...
What the hell?
What is even happening here? What is
this?
It's like every RNG in the game hates BGH. Everything is going for the BGH.
So what does MC Tech take?
Takes the Boombot, of course. Actually, if MC Tech takes then a Knife Juggler, it doesn't gain a juggle, right?
We'll
actually,
see
it does. Yeah, it does get one.
It does because of the way the battle cry triggers before the minion.
And if it swaps, it could swap turns twice, like from Sylvanas to.
I'm gonna call
Sylvanas.
It the Sudrake in the swipe. Damn.
Yeah.
I was feeling it, Gar. I think there was some potential there.
I believed in you.
That's so epic if you actually get it right to play the Zudrake to top deck swipe.
Juggler and to kill off the Boombot
into nothing. Yeah, I told you.
No, to kill you into your own Drake dies. That's kind of how it happens.
Never lucky.
Well, then again, this is not too bad either. I mean, he's got a Leon Hands turn. He's gonna get full health value out of it plus three cards. So. But there's really no two drop left in his deck, as far as I know. Like mini bots would have to come out right now.
All right. I think we spray a little bit more here, right? Yeah.
Oh, that looks really good to strive.
Spread the love.
Just to rapid fire.
Okay. So, kill off the 1-1 with the weapon, right? Oh, I guess the Boombot makes sense.
Wow, really?
It usually eats Zudrix as well.
Like, does this just happen? This just happened, right? Like, I'm witnessing this.
So. Death Rattle, kill an Azure Drake? But, you know, also the juggle hitting the face on the first on the first juggle off the reinforce ends up being costing him a juggler too.
Oh, not bad.
Yeah, and Druid's hand is better than that of the Paladins, yeah. I feel. So maybe this is an opportunity for Civitas to climb back into the game. Remember, Civitas has not won a single game with this Druid deck, and he also has refused to reveal his Warlock. So he's really insistent on making this Druid work.
He's deciding whether or not he wants to innervate out of the Shredder, right?
Yeah, but it dies to the Knife Juggler. You need to keep the Keeper of the Grove for the Tyrion. So.
Well,
Strife is also out of Master for Battle, right? He played one early in the game, and the second one just now. So the Quartermasters are kind of...
Can you just, like, tempo your opponent? Like, mini-bot, Hero Power Quartermaster, and then just push face?
That's what I'm thinking at the moment. Because he's so far out of lethal range, even with combo at the moment, that he could probably just try to force Civitas to play defensively. And if Civitas doesn't pick up taunts, then usually you're going to be fine, and you still have an Iron Beak Owl to go through it, so...
And he also just saw the MC tech.
Oh, yeah. Unless he has a second MC tech.
Oh man. That would completely...
Can you imagine?
Catch him off guard here.
Flipping the game upside down.
He'll never expect the second. He'll definitely not expect the third.
You never expect the second. You usually don't expect the first one, but you never actually...
Yeah.
Wow. That's awkward.
Let's see.
Double keeper.
So now he's threatened of dying here.
Yeah.
What? He can silence and place Sylvanas and remove 4 damage off the board. So then there's 2, 4, 5, 9 damage with True Silver. He would die to a consecrate.
Mm-hmm.
Or there's not a lot of good ways to do this. Seal of Light. Wow. Yeah. That's a card that I saw. What's his name?
Kibler played it. Yeah, Stance of Kibler.
And they were like super anti-Hunter tech cards, and they still lost Hunter.
That's so cool. I used to play one random Hammer of Wrath card run so I can remove it.
It's like, is he playing Control Pally? I don't know anymore, man. There's a Hammer of Wrath right there.
Hammer of Wrath is an aggro paladin too sometimes.
Yeah, every time.
They will never expect the random Hammer of Wrath.
He's actually just going to take 8 damage here. Like, he's setting himself up to be on 3 health, so he's actually out of range of Consec.
Does it make you guys die a little inside that you realize, like, you know, Hammer of Wrath versus Quick Shot, and you're just like, oh my god, the difference in mana.
I gave up. I gave up on the Hammer of Wrath and, like, closed beta, man.
I did. I wept a little bit for the Paladin as soon as I close saw beta. Quick Shot. I was like, rip in peace, Hammer of Wrath.
Where's my Hammer of Wrath now?
It would actually be a lethal.
That's right.
Oh.
The best argument I've ever made for Hammer of Wrath. It would be lethal.
Well, for continuing that train of thought, there's a lot of things. You could have played Nightblade for lethal.
Do you mean Stormpike Commando is now tier 1?
In some situations it's not bad. You saw it in Challenge Stone be pretty effective. I don't know if you need to silence those Sylvanas. I think on the off chance that something gets stolen, you can use it to push past the taunt for lethal.
I think you could kill your own Sylve here if you're Civitas.
Yeah, but that's a really desperate call to steal his biggest minion, like the Quartermaster, perhaps, or even the Minibot.
I'd even take the 1-2 slime here. Like. Yeah, I don't know, like, how desperate am I at this point? Like, with Savage Roar, how much can you push? Like, what can you kill? Because that's really the ultimate question, is like, how do I live through this turn? It's nice that I can remove some of that stuff. There's a lot of damage. This is kind of the strength of mid-range Pally, too, nowadays. Like, they can really just turn the tide around tempo-wise, which is not something Control Pally used to do.
I really like the tempo play as opposed to the board control play he had a few turns ago. In fact, I really like the way Strifeco played this game from beginning to end. That's not a very controversial statement that I'll make, but I think, generally speaking, he played like very well. And just according to how Paladins should approach this matchup, because I've seen too many Paladins play control-oriented when there's a lot of opportunities to beat tempo.
Well, it's going to be it for Civitas again with the Druid losing the game to Paladin on top of all the rest. So that's 4 losses for Civitas' Druid, I think.
Yeah, not the best day for
it's so mean. It feels like in so many games, there's always one guy.
There's always one guy that's
including shrugged. Myself.
Like yeah. So Trump and then Savic okay. Here getting the
you're carrying the cast. That's what you get to do today.
There's Tiddler, I think, had the problem again in week one, right? If I remember, like Tiddler didn't win yep. A single game.
Yeah. Tiddler and Colento, two players who were touted right. As like the aces of their team, end up getting pounded in week one. Not the same case today. Colento is 2-0 and done for Cloud9. Strifecrow is actually done for Cloud9 as well, I believe. So that means only Ecop remains as Cloud9 is up 5-3 and Savitz and Nairia have to win against this Hunter.
And I have to point out that it wasn't a misplay to not attack the Shredder first from Colento in the Freeze Mage game because he played around Nerubar Weblord. Because if he gets that, okay. He can't Alexstrasza.
That's right.
So it's better to play around Nerubar Weblord than it is...
The Unholy Trinity is Doomsayer.
You're right. It's like just like, yeah.
Nerubar Weblord. Never fire shots at Colento, man, if you can't back it up 100%.
Oh, snap. Right. Well, you're right, Jeff. Those guys are not our way. Makes a lot of sense. It's not a misplay at all, actually. He's got like Clento two cards works. Instead of one.
Clento works in mysterious ways, and he gets the wins.
Mm-hmm.
He gets the wins.
Plays Priest, too. Sometimes.
It's like, yeah. It's like when the thing with when you play a lot of rogues and then you see them killing Shredders last, it's mostly because of Cho, right? It's just different card you play around. You rather play around Cho than around Doomsayer, stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Low Walker Cho. Oh, man. You know, this guy, like, I wish some people one day... Like, they nerfed it so much that it's now unplayable, but it used to be a 1-mana 1-3 with the exact same effect. Like, it was really toxic in the small community that played it, because, like, you could play it in Zoo, and it was so good as a 1-mana 1-3.
Which, sorry.
Lorewalker Cho.
Lorewalker Cho, yeah. Was it 1-3? I thought it was...
It was a 1-mana 1-3, and then it became a 2-mana 1-4. But, like, initially it was a 1-mana card.
Yeah, I remember it was one of the 1-4. Okay. Lorewalker Cho is still great. Did you see that game with Nairia versus Dog, right, Gaara?
Oh my god. I casted that one.
Were you?
Yeah.
I thought it was... Okay, I thought it was me, Nimsh, and Lothar, but I guess it was me.
That was like...
Yeah, mind blown.
I mean, mistakes were made, but it's insane. A lot of insane.
Mistakes were made by everybody.
Yeah, it's like impossible to play right.
You're like, which spell do I feed him and when and how?
And then when
it gets buffed up by the oil, you're like, well, I guess I gotta keep this guy now.
And the funny thing is, people are so persistent. Nobody wants to kill it. Like, nobody wants to kill it first. It's like, oh, I want your spells.
Yeah. Like, I want to be Blade Flurry with my Death Spite, man. Come on, give it to me.
By the way, guys, as you saw the Twitter coming in once in a while. In fact, we have it pulled up right now. Loving this tournament. Amaz, something to look forward to every day before work. And all you need to do is to hashtag ATLC, and you too get 10 seconds of Twitter fame. Shout out to Crazy K for being able to join in the conversation. We have Ecop versus somebody. It's a rogue player, so that has to be Nairia.
All right, so...
Somebody. It's looking really good for Cloud9, man. Free tries on Midrange Hunter.
It's bound to take at least, one very often. You know, they just have to run at it often enough. You'll eventually get a win.
Well, it's against matchups that it might even be good against, right? The Druid and the Rogue. We don't know the Warlock yet, but the Rogue, according to Gaara, and Gaara's a big time Hunter player. You know, he's feeling the Hunter here too.
And he has like a lot of the core cards. Like the Bow is a really important card because you need to kill the free drops. He has the Coin Misha into Misha, which is also, a POP. Actually, the kill command is also underrated because killing Violet Teacher is also super important.
Yeah, if it's not played with a prep and a removal piece, very often you'll get
it. There you go. Call it.
That's
Coin Misha into Misha.
Yeah, that's really annoying to deal with. You can kill it. Just give up preparation, or you can deal with it through saps and stuff too. Whoa, but you want to save that prep for the Violet Teacher, right? Because you Violet Teacher prep sap.
Yeah, I'd imagine.
But if he coins Animal Companions, you know he has a 3 mana play again, right?
You have to save the zap for the Costas, man.
You can't sap me, I got a Wii Spell.
You are so clever. Oh my god.
Let's save the sap for the casters.
Literally the funniest man in Bosnia.
There's one man in Bosnia, no? How many people?
Like 8 million or something.
There's a lot.
I know, man.
There's a lot more than you think, for sure.
There's more people in Twitch chat than in Bosnia.
I got accused of not knowing what I was talking about because I went to Poznan in Poland, right? And I said I went to like a small city in Poland. I meant a city, and I said a small city. And it's like the second biggest city in Poland. And I knew that, and people just jumped in my throat.
You're not even American. You can't say that kind of stuff. Be careful.
Oh, yeah. I was accused of being American multiple times because of that statement.
Good stuff. Well, you can, what? Teacher,
Noxious, you're not American?
No.
No.
Well, North American, I guess. I could be considered one. I'm like from Canada.
Yeah, he's from Canada. Yeah.
I hail from Crippland.
He's from U.S. Light. You want to deal with this violent teacher as soon as possible, like you said, because the freezing traps and or just the traps in general are dealt with so well with the 1-1s.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you can't really deal with the 1-1s. Hmm. If you don't have Unleash. He doesn't have it.
Right. Knife Dragon Unleash is your best counter. Alright, quick shot. You have two weapons.
You can see with display. Yeah.
This part. Do you play Knife Dragon though, or do you just hero?
This is a deadly poison. I don't know if I would sacrifice it. Because you can get it with the Animal Companion next turn, right?
As a mid-range hunter, it's not so important to value the hero power every turn as much as with more aggressive hunters. You just want to play minions and force your opponent to use removals on it. But his hand, the thing is that his hand is very aggressive, so you kind of have to switch up your playstyle. It really have, like, according to your hand. If his hand would be like a high main, he would have played the knife juggler just to force removals. But if you have like a lot of burst damage, you value the base more.
Wow, man, that sucks. Tempo healbot. I don't think I've seen. Like, I never thought I'd say those words, but.
Well, it's basically a second Farseer, for lack of a better appropriate response. All weapons are used, though.
Yeah, and if this is a Misha.
Tempo healbot.
Oh man, what on earth is going on?
I told you, double Misha, man.
I think he just. Oh, never mind. That's gonna solve the problem.
Spell power allows you to click.
Oh, nice.
Oh, the sprint.
You might not need sprint next turn because you have Dr. Boom, but the following turn, that's great.
And the Hunter hand is really bad.
It got worse and worse, and now it's also very off curve, like no matter how you look at it.
It's all because of the tempo here, boy.
All hail your 5. This was like the worst 3 drop, like 3-3 I've ever seen. And still.
And Rio loves to see that play, man. That looks really like a desperation play. Right. I'll kill command hero power.
He's like, yeah, that works. No high main, I can do this. I get the
energy. For sure.
Oh, wow.
Boom. Fight back onto the board. Now, there is another kill command to stabilize, but Hunter used most of his damage at that point.
Yeah, but followed by Lothab, it's not half bad, is it?
No, it's definitely not bad at all, considering that you can control the state of the board, and you're hoping that you can catch a sprint.
There he is.
He's also so low on life already, the Hunter.
Oh, you're right, because you don't want this 1-1 to actually die, because then it challenges Lothab.
Oh, he died.
Yeah, but it absorbed damage, like we were talking about.
Yeah, 5-3 damage is like almost lethal.
I mean, it's totally irrelevant.
14 minus 3, 11. It's almost lethal. But you know what? It's actually true in this case, though. Yeah, you're right. It's actually really close. When you look at the way Rogue operates.
Isn't it kind of funny, though? It's like, Ekot was at like half life, which means he's dead, practically, to a lot of decks.
Yeah.
Oh, that sucks. You have to kill it. Like, if the juggle misses, you have to run the Lord.
Hit face! Okay, he definitely got lucky.
Four.
There.
Oh, I told you, almost lethal, man.
Oh, you're right.
Those bombs, man. Those bombs.
Oh my goodness, so Wait. Close.
Yeah, oh, no, you zap high main, then you tinkers and attack face.
I think you sap the high main and you just go for it, right?
Yeah.
One damage of lethal.
Wait for the
and
heal
then,
bot. I mean,
Houndmaster.
Oh, it doesn't even sap. He needs to get past the taunt. Makes sense.
Yeah, he doesn't
if you top decks.
Ooh. Imagine if that was Mister.
Misdirection.
Can you imagine the crazy plays?
Yeah, that would be so hilarious. Oh, he would probably just sprint for some damage.
Does he stop trying to mind games in Array or just escape concede?
Oh my god. I want to see the random misdirection in the tournament. Someone getting a win of it.
Wait, epic. Yeah, okay. He has the Eviscerate just in case.
Mid up Nerea.
Oh, wow. That is a play around misdirection. Doesn't matter.
Yeah, you're like, right. Never mind. Didn't matter, misdirection. What are we talking about?
And now the misdirection doesn't go off.
Yeah, vanish the casters, man. Never mind this.
Alright, well, that's gonna keep Liquid alive 5-4. E-Cup has another chance, but we did think that this was the best chance for Liquid to win. And that also means Nerea is done for the day. Which means the big story.
Can Savitz do this? Yeah.
If Savitz can take this. If Savitz can take this, then we also have another thing where E-Cup has lost, would be losing 5 games for his team too. Because he's racked up some losses himself.
And
I think he's a 3 now, right?
Sorry, what?
He's 2 losses with a Hunter and 1 with a Warrior.
I think. Yes, correct. Right now, E-Cop's 1-3. Savitz is 0-4, and right now they're basically given the same exact role, which is don't lose to the person that's been struggling today.
And we don't know the Warlock of Savitz, but usually every Warlock tends to be unfavored against Hunter.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So both decks seem to be pretty bad against Hunter.
There is one archetype that actually beats Hunter every time, and it's the hyper healing Warlock with like every removal piece you could think of, like every single bit. It's only good against like 3 decks, and nobody.
That's something
plays
you would
it.
Play, man.
Yeah, nobody plays it because it's just so horrendous. Whoa, against the, like on the ladder. But in tournaments, it's just so bad. Like in tournaments, it's actually viable, but in ladder, it's just so terrible.
Noxus would bring back like Agro Priest, super hyper healing Warlock.
Wait. Noxus, did you actually test that Agro Priest at all? Not the one in Challenge Stone, but there's a legitimate Agro Priest that was like top
it's
10
more
Chinese.
Like a tempo priest. Like I looked at it, people told me it's the Agro Priest you've always wanted to play. I'm like, no, it's not running Leprenomes and Shadow Bombers,
no.
Right?
Like it's got 2 Mind Blasts and stuff like that.
No, nobody played more Aggro Priest in tournaments than Noxious.
Yeah. Oh, wow. I've got this to say.
It's true. One more and he has a 100% win rate with it.
It's your iconic deck.
Yeah, dude. That's exactly what I am. The thing is, I've worked so hard to make it work, but it's just so horrendous. Oh, man. MC Tech's actually not even half bad against Hunter. It's, in fact, quite good in some cases.
But if you know your opponent runs MC Tech, that makes it so much worse.
Yeah, that's a good point. Although, I feel like MC Tech is not as impactful as it might be, considering that like one of the best ways for Hunter to deal with Hunter is to play Hunter. And so a lot of times, like, oh yeah, you can steal something with MC Tech, but then they kill your MC Tech and play Freezing Trap and push phase. You know, that kind of thing.
It's like, it's nice that you're focusing on these little things. Go, Huffer.
He got to choose you. In a room.
Yeah, this I feel like RNG is skewed, and it's based on players. Like, some player will get like 17 Huffers. The other one will like get like 25 Mishas. And the other one will get all the Leox that nobody else wants.
That's me. I pick up all the Leox. Someone has. Yeah,
there you go. See? That's what I'm talking about. You're like the scapegoat of all the bad animal companions. Yeah. Wait, did he get a web spinner off the web spinner? I missed that. Turns out he did. There's no other beast.
Yeah.
Oh man.
It's cool. Tavern Brawl still going for some people.
And this is so important for Hunter usually. You really want to play like those threats on curve. On 4 you want to usually play a Shredder, it's very important, but he kind of skipped that one turn. This gives like a Druid a chance to come back, you know?
Yeah. It goes from
like Web Spinner to
a Shredder. The game has slowed down considerably too, and doesn't even have Hymaint as his big threat to follow up in the mid game.
Web Spinner is a big difference compared to a Shredder. And he has the Harrison as well. Still looking bad for the Druid so far because of just the nature of Hunter.
Yeah.
Just going face.
And turn 6 is also not too bad for E-Cup. I mean, he's got the Houndmaster with the quick shot. So like using spot removal or the web spinner as a buffer for damage is also very easy. I don't think he's going to be in that much of trouble.
Yeah, it's looking good for the Hunter.
Mm-hmm.
But it could look even better.
It always looks good for the hunter.
Yeah.
when does it not look good for the hunter? It's kind of rare, right? Like, yeah.
Hmm.
I wonder if people will stop playing Druids in this tournament. Because whenever it's played, it just feels like it's losing too many games.
Bring aggro priest, man. You will just never lose to a hunter ever again.
Ever. Well, that's the thing too. I think some people feel like they have to bring druid, but as soon as like if there really is some content coming out, that's when it's going to be really exciting to watch the tournament because mm-hmm. Then you start seeing like week by week people are trying out different decks. Like maybe everyone tries the same deck at the same time because everyone's watching each other, but then you might legitimately see some teams hiding stuff and not streaming things, and like all of a sudden a new deck comes out. It's really cool.
And it's time for, yeah, this is like a card expansion, so it will be, the game will be a lot different.
Yeah.
We'll see. Hitting face seems okay. You have kill command and weapon damage and burn.
I'm going to say, do you think it's going to do anything but go
first? Yeah, like, I don't know why Ecop was like, trade.
Yeah. This feels bad, man.
This is the place. And this this could be like the entire series point for Cloud9 if this hunter wins.
Yeah.
I mean, what if, like, is the Shredder the only hope of Savitz, like, for it to really do something meaningful?
Yeah, I mean, look at that MC tech. Pretty useless here.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he could also, he also could play Sludge Belcher and then Shredder trade, like you said, and then hope something good comes out.
If Savitz could see Ecop's hand, he would concede. It's like the most, the biggest nightmare hand you can imagine.
Well, hold on. He doesn't actually have a beast to benefit off kill command except for the web spinner. And if it's a really expensive beast, you can't get the full value off of it. So he might still have a couple of turns and he can heal with Ancient of Lore. And then he has like a big board. He might threaten Savage Roar if he picks up Force Nation.
Like
it's
a
not
Noyo
like
Chon.
Completely over. Look at that.
That's decent.
Yeah, it's not completely. Of...
Mike's now.
That's pretty
good. Oh, well, that's also not too bad. This is the most complicated like a turn we'll ever get for a hunter player.
Wow.
It looks really complex.
You have some serious hunter hate, man.
It looks like one of the more complex ones.
In all your decks, don't you?
No, but it's true. Like the hunter decks seem to always have a very like somewhat straightforward play. I think it only becomes really tough when you're facing off against other hunters, where like every tiny decision like really starts mattering. That's what I found very often.
Shoot. Yeah, Unleash skill command looks fine.
Mm-hmm.
It is off curve if you do that. Which is
That's why he was considering kind of
like Lothab quick shot and slow play it, but
yeah, because the knife struggle unleash next turn just seems so strong, and you really want to get the hero powers in at this. But he can dash.
Oh, running out of time. Ecop.
No. So we decided to.
Whoa.
Oh yeah.
Okay.
Oh yeah. That's okay. That's good. Oof.
Oh, he's Well, Savitz still has a chance, then.
Oh, yeah. Keeper, MCT.
Yeah.
Pressure's gonna start piling on, though, but...
I think Savitz doesn't care so much about his minions being removed as much as if his life total.
Yeah.
Keeper BGH. Or MC Tech.
MC Tech is... increasingly less useful, but he's already used Unleash. Even if he plays something that can fill the board like Dr. Boom, he's got Big Game Hunter.
Well, this weapon's not gonna be... It's not gonna do all that Ecop wants it to.
Looks like he's just clearing the MC tag of the weapon and going low attack.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Seems like the most straightforward play, and also probably the better one in this case.
He still has like a lot of burst damage.
Mm-hmm.
Float tap gets a hit in.
Let's see. See, heal back up to 18. The thing is, Harrison also is like gaining 3 life too.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's not, yeah, exactly, it's not much weaker.
Oh, so he could next turn get something done. The thing is, he's gonna be solo on, yeah, there's like 10 damage right there, so any other source of damage is gonna be a problem. And Maexna as well, like if he plays a taunt, you punish him with Maexna, so then he has to trade everything into it.
And you always usually expect like slightly less damage from a mid-range hunter than from a phase hunter. After seeing like Unleash and One Bow and Kill Command, you usually feel safe. A little bit safe.
There's a lot of... I feel like there is still room for a comeback here, though.
Yeah. If he goes like, for the trading game, it's possible. Yeah. Because, again, if you just go face, you're afraid of getting comboed down immediately. So there's a reason why Ika is probably considering just clearing the board a little bit.
Yeah, as I said, like, I'm pretty sure Savish doesn't care about like any of his minions dying. He just wants his life to be as high as possible.
Ooh.
Oh, man.
This
no
could
way.
Be. This could get absolutely disgusting really quickly.
Oh, if that hits the BJs, that feels bad, man.
It almost doesn't matter because Quickshot kills Harrison, which is pretty solid as well. Oh man.
Yeah, only phase would be terrible.
Oh.
Oh my God.
Drake and swipe.
Whoa.
He has even the BJs to proc whatever.
Yeah, he's got it. Well.
Oh, but you want to proc the lore.
He's gonna want to play Ancient of Lore and let that bounce back.
Yeah.
Oh man. This but was this the top deck to rule them all. That was it. That is exactly what he was looking for.
Whoa!
But that makes
now the druid's looking good. Uh-oh, maybe not.
Oh, baby.
So
oh, baby.
Oh.
How often do you see that in competitive play?
Alright, Black Knight off the top. Let's do it. Let's go, boys. No, oh, okay.
You can't kill it.
You Sylvanas it, right? And then you just win.
I mean, he will die if he just plays Sylvanas, right?
Yeah. I think he kind of... thing is, like, wait, there's a freezing trap and possibly a snake, right? So...
oh, yeah. He can't even kill it, then.
Yeah, he's got to, like, Drill the Claw, taunt up, and wait. Almost, like, do that and then play Power of Shredder, see where
or
that goes.
Maybe even Drill the Claw, Savage Roar, and clear the board.
That makes the... wait, it's that doesn't look so bad for Ekop, actually, because of Maxna.
Yeah, I can't believe I'm going to say that, but Maxna might win a game.
It's probably Snake Trap freezing, right?
Yeah.
He can clear the board, though, right? If he drew the Claw Savage Roar, he charges it, and then he clears the board with the hero power on the Houndmaster afterwards.
You're right. He can use 2 minutes to kill that Maxna, and then he's going to be able to get the tempo back and heal himself up.
You don't really want to proc snakes, though.
Yeah, those three little ones are the problem. It probably is, yeah. It kind of has to be, no? I guess you could play explosive in that mid-range, but I don't see that being very likely.
Oh man, that makes no... is he gonna win him the game?
It might.
Oh,
three little
man.
Snakes that could...
that is pretty brutal.
And he had to use his only taunt for that play, so...
yeah.
Those snakes, man.
5 damage it's, right here.
Is that the Leoc top deck?
Oh wow.
Oh, no.
That's the first card.
Oh, Blizzard buffed Unleash the Hounds. Did you know that? You used to be able to play Unleash the Hounds when there was no minions on your opponent's board.
Yeah, on your board. What's up with that?
Wow.
Oh, whoa. Isn't Force...
I was going to say, isn't Force better? But then I thought about Quickshot and other stuff. He's seen two bows, right? He used 2 quick shots, 2 bows, and there's 1 kill command left, I think.
You don't play double quick shot.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. So, like, there's nothing that can really kill you.
Oh, that top deck. It's pretty huge.
No, but Savage Roar ends the game. Savage Roar number 2 ends the game.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah,
it does.
Believe
right.
in miracles.
Not today.
Oof, no.
You have to
Wild
removal.
Can still pick up a Keeper of the Grove.
Yeah, but okay, so you Wild Growth first, then you check if you get the Keeper, and if you don't, then you Force of Nature for removal and wipe the board.
Because
that really leaves you with a clean board completely.
You probably need to play Pilot Shredder. But using Force of Nature is also your only like out, so to speak, right?
Yeah. Okay.
So like that's your way you win next turn, because there's only so long you can stall before the hunter just presses for the win.
Man, this game's so close.
Then I don't see how he can I don't see how he can get away with not playing fours. I guess, yeah, as you said, Keeper of the Grove off the Wild Growth, but
okay. Like, what he's gonna need to do is have Pilot Shutter die and be Vitality Totem.
Oh man. I got three Vitality Totems yesterday.
One memorable way.
There's hope. Oh man, if that happens, then imagine losing because of Vitality Totem.
Well, now Kill Command is lethal, right?
But there's also like the
weapon, not the weapon's lethal. There's a lot.
Oh
man.
I think if this is Leoc, it's still lethal. Yeah, there it is. So, looks like it wasn't the full comeback, but the big story of the day. Savitz goes 0-5 with Druid.
Yeah, I want to say I'm surprised, but I think it's one of those, you know, weaker decks at the moment. Like, it's not weak per se, but it's not where it used to be. I mean, I know Eloise had that problem on the first week, like where I think she lost multiple games with her Druid.
Yeah, and so did Oskaka, and now Savitz. And you know what? Now Savitz joins Gaara in the 0-5 club.
Hey,
so
now
you have your second member.
Yeah, but Savitz did it with one class, though. I think it's more impressive.
I have to give him a hug.
Oh man, that's right. He was very close to going 0-6 with one class. It's just the brutal nature of the format. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, if it wasn't Savitz, it could have easily been Sho or Nairia. Based off the fact that you can't play the same class as some of your teammates. So one person will get a suboptimal lineup, or they'll get two classes that they're not as good with, or it's not good for the metagame. So it's a team effort. It's really unfair to peg this on Savitz. It's like, in the end, Team Liquid had a Druid that went 0-5. It's not just him.
No, I agree with you. I think it's more down to the class at some point. With all, you know, the level of those players, it's not really necessarily the individual skill that comes into play.
Savitz played extremely well. Yep. Like, there were like a couple very difficult decisions, and he made the right call.
Yeah, I wouldn't say like he was not the worst player today, for sure.
Yeah.
All right. Well, that wraps up our first match here, guys. Thank you so much for stopping by, Gaara. Do you have any final thoughts on the match overall?
I think we saw some very high level play overall. It was a very exciting and close match, and yeah, I enjoyed it a lot. I love you all.
Aw, love you too.
This is heartwarming.
Well, Noxious is going to probably stick around with me too. I think we have another guest caster. I believe it is Brian Kibler. He's going to be hopping on for our next match. Who do we have, Noxious?
We're going to be seeing, I think this is going to be Nihilim versus Celestial. So it's going to be Life Coach, Thice, and RDU versus Tiddler, Frozen Ice, and Silent Storm. I think week one, you know, the Celestial team had a bit of a rough time. Tiddler, actually, the coach, had the roughest of times. RDU had a bit of a, like, his own, I guess, 1-3 score. He wasn't very satisfied with, but he said that his team supported him, so it didn't really play too much into his ability to play well. So we'll see if they can get another win this week.
Feels like every match, there's at least one person that's down in the dumps, and we'll find out who that's going to be right after this break. You're watching the ATLC.